The day we celebrate the first glorious anniversary of the information purification collectives. We have created, for the first time in all history, a garden of pure ideology where each worker may bloom, secure from the pests of a contributory force. Our unification of force is more powerful a weapon than any fleet or army on earth. We are one people. One will, one resolve, one cause. Our enemies shall talk themselves to death, and we will bury them with their own confusion. We shall prevail.
Broadcasting will now be discontinued for an indefinite period. I repeat, normal broadcasting will be discontinued for an indefinite period.
Today, the Federal Communications Commission empowers America's new media elite with unacceptable levels of influence over the ideas and information upon which our society and our democracy depend.
Normal broadcasting will now be discontinued for an indefinite period. I repeat, normal broadcasting will be discontinued for an indefinite period.
What does the future hold in store for us? To get a glimpse of that future, Army-Navy Screen Magazine presents a new department. Tomorrow, previewing our post-war world.
Let's take a look at what is actually happening now.
9 experimental telecasting studios are already operating, with pre-war equipment and skeleton staffs. While the electronic industry is busy finishing its war job, a handful of people, girls, ex-vets, older men, are keeping the television field alive, experimenting, ironing out kinks, but proving that television will definitely be part of American life when the go-ahead comes. Sight teamed up with sound to bring the world to your easy chair. Telecasting studios will be a combination of Broadway and Hollywood, and you'll get the best of both for the price of your television set and a few cents worth of electricity.
The communist government of the former Soviet Union thought that by controlling access to information, they could keep their citizens in line. Consistent with the Orwellian nature of the Soviet Union, the country's most important newspaper was Pravda. Pravda is the Russian word for truth. But Pravda was not truth. It was full of lies. But here's the thing. Almost no one in the Soviet Union was fooled. They knew they were being lied to. Ironically, unlike most citizens in the Soviet Union, citizens in 21st century America are fooled by their news media. We think we're getting the real story from our major media, but we're not. When we tune into the networks or read the New York Times or the Washington Post, we're actually getting a sharply slanted version of the news, slanted to the left. This should deeply concern people on both sides of the political divide. To make informed decisions, a free society needs a press it can trust, not one that is hopelessly biased. In 2017, Project Veritas sent out undercover reporters to see how committed the major media was to objective news gathering, specifically as it regarded the newly elected president, Donald Trump. Our first report focused on CNN. A producer there, John Bonifield, acknowledged the lack of evidence for his network's efforts to link the Trump campaign and the Russian government in a plot to rig the 2016 election. Bonifield told us, "I think the president is probably right to say, like, look, you are witch hunting me. You have no smoking gun. You have no real proof." So why was CNN so relentless in hammering the Russia collusion narrative? Ideology, the election wasn't legitimate, and ratings. As Bonifield noted, the Trump-Russia collusion story was good for business. Next, we released another series of reports, these on the New York Times. First, we heard from Nick Dudick, the paper's audience strategy editor. Dudick told our undercover reporter he was responsible for choosing which New York Times videos go on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Dudick boasted, "My imprint is on every video we do." And what was that imprint about? As Dudick, who worked on both the Obama and Hillary Clinton campaigns, told our reporter, he hoped to use his position to make the president's life as difficult as possible. "I will be objective," he told our reporter with undisguised sarcasm before revealing his true intentions. "No, I'm not. That's why I'm here." Dudick told us he returned to journalism precisely in order to remain politically active. Next, we met Des Shu, an editor for the paper. She made it clear where she stood. "I think one of the things that maybe journalists were thinking about is like, oh, if we write about Trump and how insanely crazy he is and how ludicrous his policies are, then maybe people will read it and be like, oh, wow, we shouldn't vote for him." According to the Times' own handbook on journalistic ethics, journalists may not do anything that damages the Times' reputation for strict neutrality in reporting on politics and government. So given such a breach of the Times' own standards, we expected the newspaper to come down hard on Dudick and Shu. Instead, they came down hard on us. Executive editor Dean Baquet said I was a despicable person for recording one of his employees telling the truth. Yet, when the Times publicized a 2012 undercover video of Republican presidential candidate Mitt Romney saying that 47% of Americans wouldn't vote for him because they were dependent on the government, they praised it as offering a rare glimpse of Romney's personal views. In fact, in his attack on us, Baquet unwittingly gave the whole American media game away. A real journalist, he told a panel at the National Press Club, has to have in his or her heart a desire to make society better. The Times' editor is wrong. Real journalists want to pursue the truth. Then they let the citizens use that truth to build a better society. When journalists shape news to fit their vision of a better society, they're not doing their job. Perhaps this wouldn't be so bad if the major media would just admit their political motives. But they don't. On behalf of their own narrow agenda, they lie, distort, and exaggerate. And they expect us to call it Pravda. But with each passing day, fewer and fewer Americans are willing to do so. I'm James O'Keefe, founder and president of Project Veritas for Prager University. Thank you for watching this video. To help keep PragerU videos free, please consider making a tax-deductible donation.
Hi, this is Cindy Williams, and you're watching TV-Free Baltimore.
This is Gunhild Carling, and you are watching TV-Free Baltimore. You are not watching. You have to watch TV Free Baltimore.
As a public service, TV Free Baltimore provides a digital soapbox for those the mainstream media ignores. The opinions expressed in this live stream are not necessarily those of the owners, management, or underwriters of TV Free Baltimore. Furthermore, TV Free Baltimore streams hyper-local content focusing on politics and entertainment in the Baltimore viewing area.
Hello, this is Paul Stefan, and welcome to TV Free Baltimore's first live segment. We are striving to go forward with all kinds of innovations that we hope that you will enjoy. We're going to be having traffic and weather reports, hopefully every morning. We'll have live streaming, as we're doing right now. We're going to have remote interviews, which are really going to open up a lot of possibilities for us to bring you people with their various views from all over the country and all over the world. And we also are going to be using split screens, which you may also see tonight in just a few minutes. The remote interviews really thrills me. Way back in the early 50s, Edward R. Murrow, the great journalist, started a show called See It Now, where he went into the homes of celebrities and important people and spoke to them. And we're going to do some of that here, too, in a show I want to call Window on the World. What we want to do, though, because I am sort of like the host you see most of the time, I have a problem that you can help me with. I don't want to be on here all the time. We need people like you to come in here, work with us. We see this as the People's Channel, where we will, as that gentleman in the previous video said, we want to give people who aren't heard a voice because so few corporations control about 90% of the media, and we want to cover what isn't covered and the voices that are unheard. We want to enlighten and we want to entertain. So if you or anybody you know would like to be behind the camera as a camera person, a sound editor, a writer, director, please get in contact with us. Also, if you want to be in front of the screen as a host or come up with a great idea for a show, this is your channel. We're going to keep trying to bring you things that are very entertaining. But first, you know, we're another new first for us is we've had our first sponsor. TV Free Baltimore, always be free to you, the viewer. But we expect to get revenue through the sponsorship of small businesses, and hopefully that way we grow together, the small businesses and TV Free Baltimore. And our first sponsor is Vino's Liquor and Bar. It's a place where friendly places with plentiful selections and always a good time. Visit Vino's at 3811 North Point Road, Dundalk, Maryland, 21222. Locally owned and locally operated. Open 7 days a week, even on holidays. And again, if you know any small businesses that you'd like to have us have on the show here, we'll do the commercial. They can sponsor a show or run an ad. Now, for tonight, we're going to have an interesting variety of programs. We're going to start with a show of books and authors, with the book Paul Lynn, A Biography, written by Kathy Rudolph. Kathy Rudolph will be one of my first live remote interviews for a 30-minute spot, so we can talk about the book and her history as a very good friend of Paul Lynn's. Then we will have a show of Maryland politics, where David Lashar, who is running for the 3rd District Congressional seat as a Libertarian. Then there will be a movie reviews with Baltimore-based actor who makes tons of films, Johnny Alonzo. And later we hope to have a live interview with Johnny from the set of another movie he is doing right now with the other members of the cast. And we will finish with a Paul Stefan show with singer-songwriter Athena Hiotis. And that's going to be a great show. And so what we're going to talk about a little too is tease you with what's coming in the future. What we want to do is say we have a guest with us tonight. And this is Strider, who is the regional director of the Baltimore Guardian Angels. And he wants to tell you a little bit about a program that he's going to be the star of. Strider, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Strider. I'm the regional director for the Guardian Angels here in Baltimore. Some of you have already heard of our podcast show that we used to have called Beyond the Streets. With TV Free Baltimore, what we're going to be able to do now is we're going to be able to put our own shows together to talk about what it is the Guardian Angels are doing in our community, what it is you are doing inside your community. So we're going to be able to talk to the community leaders. We're going to be able to go to the meetings. We're going to be able to talk to Guardian Angel chapters around the world about what it is they are doing. You think about it, the Guardian Angels were basically born to help victims of crime and abuse. But You'll be surprised how many people around the world are doing the exact same thing that this Guardian Angel chapter is doing right here. So with TV Free Baltimore, we're going to have the chance to connect with them and talk about some of the same issues that we have, that they're having around the world. We're going to be able to bring your community issues and complaints and needs and services right here to the screen, everybody else. And we're going to be able to put it out there the way we want to. We're going to be able to talk about what we need to talk about. It's not going to be edited. It's not going to be cut off. This is what we need here. So I look forward to putting these shows together, and I look forward to you being a part of them. So TV Free Baltimore, we're ready to go beyond the streets. So make sure you join in.
Great. Thank you, Strider. Now, future programming, I'll teach you with that a little bit. We're going to have a couple of gentlemen who grew up in Baltimore City streets. They're both involved in what will be a big blockbuster film in 2019. You have to tune in. One's an actor, one is a grip on the crew. We also will be having Kenny Johnson, who's a cinematographer and what he calls a content creator, and find out what that is. We will have stunt actors, Karen Carbone and Rick Kane, in here in a week or so. And we just got the approval that we're going to have Baltimore's own well-known singer-songwriter Ellen Cherry in here, as well as filmmaker Alexis Barone with an interview, on her movie When I Leave. It'll be the third movie we'll be showing. And also, we'll be talking to guitar maker Bob Flowers, two of Baltimore's local magic legends, George Gobel, who owns the A.T. Jones & Company costume company that's 150 years old this year, who was the last of the big show magicians with all the dancing girls and the assistants, and he's in the white tie and tails. And we're going to have a great time going to his house and seeing some of his collection that he's had over the years, including some things that belong to Houdini. And then we'll also be looking to speak with Spencer Horseman, who has his own theater down there on South Charles Street, and we'll go to his theater, and he is a magician and escape artist. And that's just a little bit. Tell us, please, what you want to see, what kind of shows you want to see, who we should interview. We want it to be something you want to see. And that's about all I've got right now. So please watch the rest of tonight's stream. Enjoy it. And let us know your comments. And please like and share what you see so that we can all grow together. Thank you.
Hey there, folks. This is Lenny Rudo from Fish Talk Magazine, and you're watching TV Free Baltimore.
Welcome to TV Free Baltimore's Books and Authors.
When I was 17 years old, I watched Paul on the Hollywood Squares and Uncle Arthur. I thought he was a very handsome man. I also thought he was the most funniest, unique man ever. I did a lot of research at my local public library. And a book said it had Paul Lynn's business manager's phone number. Oh. I call the number. It's Paul Lynn himself answering the phone. He couldn't believe a fan found his phone number. I convinced him to meet me in New York. He was coming to New York. He lived in California. At first, he said no. I asked him to the prom on the phone. He said no. Can you meet me? And time went on. I finally convinced him for an autograph and a picture in Manhattan for 5 minutes.
Okay.
I go to meet him at the Pierre Hotel where he was staying. And the hotel's on fire.
Oh, no.
So the whole day, my dad escorted me, which was why Paul said I could come as long as my dad took me. And was supposed to be a 5-minute interview, turned into 2.5 hours.
Wow.
Gave me my picture and autograph, and then he wrote something on a piece of paper, and I said, you know, what is this? He says, this is my home address. I want you to come and visit me. Terrific. And we had a lifelong friendship from that moment on till he died in 82.
That's amazing. So you should be almost the authorized biography.
There you go. Well, the Lind Estate is well aware of the book, and they seem to be happy with it. And they gave me some unique, rare pictures of Paul that no one has ever seen to put in the book. And I also interviewed Cloris Leachman, Kay Ballard. Peter Marshall gave me a foreword for the book. Unbelievable. It just came full circle. I wanted to meet him. I also always wanted to be an author since I was little. And it turned around that I ended up writing a book, and it happens to be about Paul Lind that I got to meet.
Did you interview other members of his family?
Yes, I did. I interviewed. The only ones that are left are his nieces, and they both gave me some wonderful interviews about what it was like having him as Uncle Paul, because it's Uncle Arthur from Bewitched,
right,
and so now we got Uncle Paul.
Right. And I know he was also in Bye Bye Birdie.
Oh, yes, he was. He was in the original Broadway play, which Champion Gower wanted him for the part, and Paul was excited. But then when he saw the script, it was only 9 lines. He got very upset, and they promised him, Gower promised him it would turn into a bigger part. Well, Paul's so funny, the part just grew, and he was a hit from there.
Now, maybe earlier, I mean, how did he get to be known? Did he start off as a stand-up, or what was it?
He went to Northwestern for acting, and was popular with Charlotte Ray, known then as Charlotte Lebowski. And they were the most popular at Northwestern, called Lyndon Lebowski.
Okay.
And he walked out with the best actor of Northwestern, went to Manhattan, thought it was going to be easy, and he wasn't discovered for 9 more years. He went on 1952, the New Faces of 52.
Oh, okay.
Got noticed.
Okay.
It was quiet again for a long time, and then he ended up getting the part for Bye Bye Birdie. That opened the doors.
And that launched it for him from
For the next 30-year career from The Monsters. Until
he,
unfortunately, in 1982.
Yeah, that's a shame, yes.
Yeah, that was a sad day.
And is there anything you can tell folks as to why they should read this book and why we should rediscover this man?
Paul Lind was a very personal man. He was a man who, at the time of your career, if you were gay, you'd lose your career. He trusted me. I got a glimpse at his very personal life. And people did not know anything about Paul except what they read in the papers. And he did have a drinking problem. And everything in this book is the good and the bad. It's a fair book.
Okay.
I think Paul would like it.
Okay.
I think he'd be okay with it. But I do have everything in there, the good and the bad. And everybody has vices. He had a lot. We all do. But I balanced it. And I wanted people to see the other side of Paul. And yes, he was funny. And to go out with him, a scream. A real scream.
Sure, he was very generous as far as he was with his time with you, at least.
He was at the height of his career. He didn't have to bother with me. Took me into his life.
17-year-old girl.
Yeah, and went on into my 20s, and my friend Barbara over there was at his house with me. He welcomed my friends.
That's good.
And we had a wonderful relationship until he died.
I think part of what I do is say we want to hear the real people. They were really like, not what people think they were.
What they think they were like, and rumors, and this.
Yeah,
I think I gave you.
Yeah, that was there. You know, in the old days, the phrase would be flaming gay.
Yeah, exactly.
Thing, you know?
Yeah. But he was, I wasn't so sure he was gay when I first liked him, but.
Yeah.
But, you know, he left me for a waiter one night, so.
Oh, then you figured it
I
out.
I figured it out, yeah.
Maybe
yeah, that
broke
was,
your
that
heart,
was it.
I don't
yeah, yes, it did. It broke my heart. I didn't speak to him the next day for a little while, but we ended up working it out. And then I loved him for who he was.
Was he a. You think an actor who prepared a lot? I mean, was he?
Oh my gosh, he was.
He didn't just wing it.
No, he was a perfectionist, a script man. If he did a movie, he not only knew his lines, he knew everybody else's lines as well. A real perfectionist.
Terrific.
Could be tough to work with because if your timing's off. Cheetah Rivera gave me a great interview about her and Paul at the original Bye Bye Birdie, and she said, you know, he did get tough with people if they weren't on time or they ruined his timing, but. She said she never heard more laughter and applause than when Paul Lind was on stage. And that's, you know, we all remember Paul watching Hollywood Squares come home from a hard day. You're sad.
Right.
He made you cheer you up.
The center square.
That's a center square.
That's right. He was like, you know, the star when you're in that center square.
Absolutely. And he did well for his career.
It seems like this for you then was really like a labor of love.
Oh, absolutely. I loved the research. I loved everything doing it about him. And, the hardest part was, you know, writing the chapter about when he died.
Right, of course. course.
But the rest of the book, I think people will get to know him. I wish he was here because...
Yeah, that would be great. I would have liked to have met him myself.
They'd line up to see him and he'd be hysterical today just as he was. And he was a lot of fun.
Didn't see how I think public opinion has changed about homosexuality.
Oh, yes. I think he'd be thrilled that he could be open if he wanted to. And I think he'd be great on a reality TV show. As a cook, because he was a cook, you know, chopping up the carrots, chopping. Yeah,
he was a good cook.
He was a gourmet. He was known as a gourmet cook in Hollywood.
Wow.
Yeah, very.
Terrific.
He entertained all the time.
How about that? Now, is this it for you? You have other books you're thinking about or planning?
If I do another book, I was thinking going fiction for the next one, but I'm not so. My passion is with Paul, and I just think the world. There's still a lot of this world who love Paul, who aren't even aware of his life story, and I want people to see that before I go to my next project.
Terrific. Well, we want to thank you for spending a little time with
us. Oh, my pleasure. It was fun.
And people can find this book where?
Amazon.com, and just Google it. It's there. Just Google Paulin. You get Paulin and Kathy or Paulin, a biography. His life is love, his laughter.
And you want to give us maybe, you know, people can reach you, like an email address or whatever.
Sure.
Please,
you can. It's the... I'm on Facebook at Paul Lind, a biography, his life, his love, and his laughters. You can also go on, I guess Amazon, there's a link to me also, you can find it for the author page.
Okay, you don't like have your own author webpage.
I actually do. It's www.paullindabiography.com.
Okay, well, thank you again.
My pleasure.
And keep up the good work.
Thank you, and thank you for the interview.
You're watching Books and Authors on TV Free Baltimore.
If you live and travel in the National Capital Region, you know how bad traffic congestion is on the roadways. Today, the Capital Beltway carries nearly 250,000 travelers each day and is congested approximately 10 hours a day. I-270 carries more than 260,000 people and is congested approximately 7 hours a day, and those numbers are projected to increase. That's why the Maryland Department of Transportation, MDOT, has introduced an innovative plan to reduce congestion on these and other roads in the state, the Maryland Traffic Relief Plan. This system of systems will keep Maryland citizens and the Maryland economy moving and thriving. The Traffic Relief Plan on I-495 and I-270 is looking at transformative improvements along the entire stretch of both interstates. This massive effort will be a public-private partnership, or P3. A P3 is a method of delivering public infrastructure projects, such as highway improvements, with an agreement between a public owner, such as MDOT-SHA, and a private entity. The private entity will perform functions normally undertaken by the state, which may include designing, building, financing, operating, and maintaining a transportation facility. The I-495 I-270 P3 program will focus on transformative improvements along over 70 miles of interstate, the full lengths of I-495 and I-270. The first element of the I-495 and I-270 P3 program is called the I-495 and I-270 Managed Lane Study. This is an environmental study extending along I-495 from south of the American Legion Bridge in Virginia to east of the Woodrow Wilson Bridge and along I-270 from I-495 to I-370, including the east and west I-270 spurs. The Federal Highway Administration, as the lead federal agency, and MDOT-SHA, as the local project sponsor, will prepare an Environmental Impact Statement, or an EIS, for the I-495 and I-270 Managed Lane Study. This will be done in accordance with the National Environmental Policy Act, also known as NEPA, and other legal mandates. The EIS will document the project scoping process, purpose and need development, corridor alternative analysis and screening, traffic and environmental analyses, and public and agency involvement. Your input is vital to the NEPA process, beginning with the initial scoping and comment period. The Federal Highway Administration and MDOT-SHA are seeking input from all interested individuals, organizations, and public agencies on the scope of the study, including the purpose and need, potential alternatives to be studied, environmental impacts to be considered, and evaluation methods to be used. More information on public outreach activities, including future public workshops, will be available on the study website, www.495-270-p3.com. Throughout the study, we invite you to check the project website to learn more. You can also sign up to be notified of events and opportunities in connection with the study. And you can contact us via email through the website. The I-495 and I-270 Managed Lane Study brings MDOT's traffic relief plan to the most congested roads in the state, reducing drive times and helping to connect all Marylanders to life's opportunities. We look forward to hearing from you.
What is capitalism? It's all about supply and demand, freedom, choice, and incentive. So, supply and demand is how capitalism sets prices. If you are selling something, you can charge any price you like for it. But if you're buying something, you can pay what you like for it too. So, the actual price is what the seller and the buyer both agree on. What that normally means is that rare things are worth a lot of money. Lots of places sell apples. If someone tries to make me pay a fiver for an apple, I'll just go somewhere else. Apple computers, though, are expensive. I can't buy them cheaper, so it's a choice of paying what the seller wants or just not having one. The same is true of skills. If I can do something nobody else can, I can charge a lot for my time. If anyone can do my job, it's harder to get paid a lot. At the heart of capitalism, then, is freedom. Nobody can tell you what to do to earn money, nor how to spend it. It's entirely up to you. This creates a vast range of choice. You create your own path by choosing education and training. You might be able to get a better paid job in the future. Or you can start work in whichever sector you want to. Fans of capitalism say it works because of incentives. You want more money, so you'll be more inventive, either to make something new and desirable, or to cut the costs on existing products, making them cheaper. So, both of these things are good for everybody else. You are rewarded with more profit, and both you and the consumer are better.
You're watching Maryland Politics here on TV Free Baltimore.
Good evening and welcome to another great episode of Maryland Politics. I'm your host, Derek Sterling, and my guest this evening is Libertarian David Lasher. I want to welcome David Lasher to the studio. How are you doing tonight?
I'm good, Derek. Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I love interviewing libertarians just because, you know, as we were talking pre-show here, you know, I'm still trying to figure out where I sit in all of this. Like, you know, people have to understand that, you know, you can't ignore what's happening in the world. You can't. Why? Because we all live in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that takes place affects us one way or another, whether we want to admit it or not. Okay, if we want to just put the blinders on.
Be an ostrich.
Stick our head in the sand. Even then, the world will affect us in some way. So, you know, the more I hear the libertarians speak on philosophy and, you know, ideals, things that could essentially change the way things are, period. The way the government is ran.
We need to do that.
You know, these things matter, and it should matter to everybody. And I just think that, you know, somebody like yourself who says, you know, you bring this flyer, and it grasped my attention. I read it. It says, socially tolerant and fiscally responsible. So I mean, just elaborate a little bit, and we'll go a little deeper into it. And I know, you know, there's a lot to talk about, but, you know, introduce yourself as far as, you know, what your mission is, and explain a little bit about what you're saying here in the first couple words in your brochure.
So thank you. And socially tolerant, fiscally responsible, great setup, great first question. How did I get to that, and why is it important to me? Let me start with what the standard definition of libertarianism is. And I only became a libertarian, I switched parties from the Republican Party this past winter, January, February. And I had begun to ask myself, what party do I belong in after the 2016 presidential election cycle? Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people were asking themselves that question. I was, until very recently, an official in the Hogan administration. I was serving proudly for Governor Hogan, but still I had these questions because of about what party should I belong to? What party represents me? What party has the vision of America that I think is the right vision, the vision that resonates with me? And at the national level, I realized through 2016 and 17 that it wasn't the Republican Party. Mm. And so I began to reflect on what that meant for me and what I had to do, and I obviously decided to join the Republican Party, the Libertarian Party. Mm. And the reason is, as I started to look around, I needed to find a home that I felt was principled, that stood for something. And I began to read about the Libertarian Party and watch videos, as we can do today with the internet and YouTube and the many stations on it, channels on it. And what I found about the Libertarian Party is that, first of all, it calls itself the party of principle. All right, well, you can call yourself something but still not be it.
Right.
And so what is that principle? The foundational principle of the Libertarian Party is that individuals should be able to do as they choose as long as what they choose is not going to hurt anybody else. Mm-hmm. That's the fundamental principle. And it's a good starting place. Now,
sure it is.
And that resonates with me. But I had to make it my own. And I grew up as I reached my 18th birthday, became a voter in the early Reagan years. And I was very comfortable in Reagan's Republican Party. I think I was comfortable there because there was a type of conservatism that used to be called compassionate conservatism. Mm. Right? Conservatism okay. with a heart, right?
Yeah, I have never heard of that, but I felt that during that era. I remember that era.
Jack Kemp, do you remember Jack Kemp?
He had been. I remember the name. Yes, I do. I was young then, so.
I was younger.
Absolutely, I do remember hearing that name, though.
And that current of conservatism was where I swam. I was comfortable there. And I went through my 20s, my 30s, my 40s. Yes, I've gone through all.
You're telling your age now, sir.
I continue to go. I always thought of myself as something that a lot of people think of themselves as. And that is, you hear this a lot, I'm socially liberal but fiscally conservative. You hear that a lot.
I've heard that said quite often.
I think I used to say that about myself a lot. Mm-hmm. I think recently it's become questionable not just what a conservative is, but what a liberal is.
Yeah.
That's why you said, why socially tolerant and fiscally responsible?
Yeah. That's where it all adds up and makes sense.
My aha.
Combination. But not quite either or.
My aha was in a conversation with a fellow libertarian, and it came together. The movie The Matrix,
mm-hmm.
and the favorite. Numbers are going down the screen, mm-hmm. right? And it's just green. But if you somehow saw it, you had your insight. You could the numbers came together, and you could see what was actually happening. My moment like that was, you know what? I'm not liberal, I'm not conservative anymore, because the liberals within the Democratic Party have gone a direction. They become progressives and radicals, and I can't be with them because their liberalism is no longer liberal. It's no longer about tolerance. Mm-hmm. Look at the college campuses. Right? Yeah. People shouted down for their beliefs.
Yes.
People can't even come to speak because of threats of violence. That's wrong.
Yeah, that is wrong. And it's almost being allotted to a degree. They're tolerating it as a freedom of speech or freedom to react the
they're
way
they're saying there shouldn't
to.
Even be freedom of speech. Yeah. They are denying some people and voices on campuses, but resonant ones. I mean, not voices that are to be dismissed because they are influential voices on campuses across the country. They're saying we can't even have free speech. They're saying if I don't like your ideas, that is violence, physical violence. I don't agree.
It's changed. It's not you. I have a saying, the freedom of speech. Okay, to me, it seems like it was a great thing to implement, to put into place.
However, it still is.
However, the repercussions come from what we say. So where was the governing for what could potentially happen after you utilize all your freedom of speech?
We meet speech with speech. We meet ideas with ideas. We follow the examples of Gandhi in India. We follow the example here in America of MLK, Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And we take the high road. We endure listening and bearing what we're hearing, and we give an example of the better, and we respond with the higher call, the better argument. We do not silence others. We do not shout them down. I think that there has been because I was thinking through all these questions for myself over recent months. I did go back and read what I read in college, some of the speeches and letters from Martin Luther King, and his letter from Birmingham jail. And to give you further hints as to my age, he was writing, he wrote the letter from, I was born between the letter from Birmingham jail and the I Have a Dream speech in Washington, D.C.
Wow.
That's right, I was right in between I was born.
And pardon the interruption, but you're from where? What are you from, Maryland?
No, I moved here with my wife about 10 or 12 years ago. And I was born in New York, Pennsylvania, so just up 83, right? So South Central Pennsylvania. My dad was in the steel industry. He was a sales person in the steel industry.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he did well and got promotions, we moved to another city. So it was from York to Louisville, Kentucky. So I was age 4 to age 11 in Louisville, Kentucky. I still have a y'all sneak out every now and then.
I'm sorry. Y'all.
I still feel.
Y'all.
Y'all.
Of course. Southerner.
moved to Pittsburgh from there for my middle school years. High school between Cleveland and Akron in Ohio. So mid-Atlantic. I don't consider my part. I don't consider Eastern Ohio to really be the Midwest. It's the very beginning of the Midwest, right? That's the areas that I grew up in. But as I went back and was recently, for reasons just mentioned, reading some of what I had read in college, it struck me that the courage of MLK and those who marched in the civil rights movement and in Birmingham. And what they were facing. They were facing snarling dogs. They were facing fire hoses. They were facing real violence. their persons were truly at risk, because after they marched together, they were singled out when they went home.
Yeah. A lot of vandalism, a lot of attacks, threats.
The KKK was strong.
Yeah, at that time period.
People got lynched. Mm-hmm. That is not the reality. It is not even close to the reality that we find on college campuses today. The words of even a modest conservative like George Will, who's a national columnist, he is absolutely very mainstream, writes for the Washington Post. College campuses refuse to have, not all, but he has been refused at college campuses because his words supposedly hurt. He has to be listened to. This isn't Birmingham. This isn't Snarling Dogs. This is George Will perhaps trying to share ideas that college professors themselves aren't sharing with their students.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course. Man?
Because this is something that is something I've really taken some time to think about for a while.
Yep.
And I have these conversations with myself. You know, I don't really share them with a lot of people. But now I have an opportunity to actually talk to somebody who knows some things and was actually around during that time period. So why is it that most college professors, who should be considered some of the most brilliant people in the world,
yes,
in the world, some of these schools that they actually do, you know, teach at, why have they taken the more liberal approach on teaching methods? Where does that come from when a lot of them understand science and logic and, you know, it's a fine line between religion and the two. So how does that work? I'm not sure. To me, it seems like it would have went the other way around with the knowledge that these people have because they're so intelligent.
If you're not willing to expose your beliefs and ideas to facts, to debate, let's say, because mm-hmm. we can debate what facts are. Mm-hmm. Right? Completely accept that. But if you're not even open to the discussion and the debate, then you are holding your beliefs as a member of a religion holds their beliefs.
I understand.
You're not using reason, you're using faith.
You explained it just that fast, and it makes sense.
And that's what Marxism is. Now, here's something I haven't shared with you yet. Mm-hmm. When I was in college, I was raised in a nice family. I was the eldest in the family, two younger sisters. So we were, though my parents became upper middle class, my childhood was solid middle class. In the suburbs of the late 60s and through the 70s. And I knew that I was blessed, that I had privilege, not the way that privilege is used as an indictment today, mm-hmm. but as a blessing. I had parents taking care of me who emphasized education first and foremost. And I ended up with the opportunity to go to an elite college in New England. And as I did so, in the days, this was before the internet, so mm-hmm. so you get accepted and they would send you a catalog, you know, paper, hundreds of pages.
I have no idea what you're talking about, sir.
I know. For the millennials out there, I know that's difficult to comprehend. But it's true. That's the way the world used to work.
I mean, there wasn't email back then?
There wasn't. So you get the catalog, and I went through it, and I didn't know what I wanted to study. And I thought, like everybody says, you're going to be a doctor, and I said, sure, perhaps. I saw that if I studied the Russian language for 2 years, freshman sophomore years, I would then have the opportunity to go to the Soviet Union.
Hmm.
When it was the Soviet Union,
yeah.
It was in the 80s,
yep.
Early mid-80s. And that was, that's what I decided to do. I couldn't, that's, I said, I have to do that. And I think, I think the reason was that what I wanted to do was have the experience of the compare and the contrast of the two different societies, the two different systems, because
communism and what we call democracy.
Yeah, democracy.
Democratic style of governing.
Unless you use D's and R's, our democratic republican, republic, right? Yeah, small d, small r, right?
Yes, sir.
So
brilliant, brilliant.
And also, let me, like all kids, I was an idealist, and I wasn't reading my Marx, but I was fond of Eugene Debs, the labor leader from early in the 20th century, and violent. He was good with violence in his cause.
I'll take your word for it.
What I remember, right? But I believed in his cause. I mean, his cause resonated with me. The leading socialist in the first half of the 20th century in the U.S. was Norman Thomas, and I'm no student of Norman Thomas, but I read some of him, and socialism from Norman Thomas, as opposed to from Marx, it resonated with me. Mm-hmm. The populism of Huey Long down in the Kingfish, down in Louisiana, also resonated with me, because these were people. I'm standing for office, and I am going to passionately work for the people of the Maryland Third, for the people of the state of Maryland, for the people of the United States. If I get the opportunity to serve, I do not like those who stand up and pound on the table and say, "I'm going to fight for you." Mm-hmm. We don't need fighting.
Okay.
Right? We don't need Khrushchev banging his shoe on the table. It's theatrics, and it's not theatrics.
That's exactly what
it is. It's not helpful. Especially right now, we need less of that.
I love that point that you're making, and that's something that I haven't confronted thus far out of the libertarians that are running for positions this year, so far in this election season, and that's, although they might feel that way, the same way you do,
yep.
It hasn't been stated, and it's not about fighting, and I agree with you there. There's enough of that. Everybody claims that there's this great fight, and this fight, and we're fighting, when realistically, we're all here, we all have to do something to play a part. You're not going to be able to do it all by yourself. You're going to need people to go along, a lot of people to actually go along with your ideas of how to make things better, and together we can do that. You know, together we can, you know, all pitch in and contribute. You're running against a John Sarbanes. And you don't have to go all into about this person. I know this isn't a bashing session or anything like that, but, you know, how do you feel, or what makes you feel as though you stand a chance running against this individual for that position?
Well, the reason that I feel I stand a chance is that I do not believe that Mr. Sarbanes has the right ideas for this district.
Okay.
He is very much in line with the program, the proposals, the politics of Senator Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, the progressive caucus of the House. And those ideas are not the right ideas to improve the lives of Marylanders or Americans. What I would like to do is elaborate that on future sessions.
Okay.
Right? I think that Mr. Sarbanes seems, from the little bit that I know about him and have heard about him, mm-hmm. to be an entirely decent individual. Mm-hmm. But I do and will be critiquing his ideas. I will be critiquing his record, which is not a record of strong accomplishment after he's finishing up 12 years of service now. And I look forward to talking about that over the summer and fall.
That matters, okay? So I don't you can, you'll continue to go on. I know you got a lot to say, but that point you just made matters. You know, what have you done? You know, it's almost like, you know, when Obama was in office, you know, mm-hmm. and I voted for Obama, but you look back and you say, well, what was accomplished during your tenure?
And I think it is a necessary question of any incumbent, right, to say, what have you done? I think in Mr. Sarbanes' case, he's had 12 years of service, and I think that his record of accomplishment is very slight indeed.
Doesn't that just mean it's just time for change? I mean, now the thing about that, though, is you just don't want to change into something that's exactly the same. You don't want to, you don't want to put the same kind of person in office that have similar tendencies, or there, no real positive change is going to happen.
So I think that what's different about American politics today, now that we've settled into the early 21st century, mm-hmm. right, and is different from the 20th century that we were born in and grew up in, and the 20th century is the century that I know some of the history of. And I think what's different in American politics today than 20 years ago, and I think it only began to become clear under President Obama and now up President Trump, is that it's time for us to leave behind the two-party system with only the two choices that did serve us well in the 20th century, certainly. And look, the 19th century was not just a two-party system. It wasn't. 20th century had existential overseas threats to our liberties, to our ongoing existence as a nation. And that brought us together. And the debates between the Republicans and the Democrats were genuine debates and frequently passionate, but they were on a political spectrum that was narrower than what this political spectrum has become today in terms of ideas and policies that, you know, significant numbers of people endorse. And so today, I think we've outgrown the two parties. I think mm-hmm. that we need.
I agree with you.
I'm going to say three parties, and I'm the libertarian here. I think that we need a single party devoted to the ideas of the progressive left, mm-hmm. right? Of Bernie Sanders and those who are enthusiastic about that which he proposes. That he himself enthusiastically describes, unashamedly and unabashedly describes as Marxism, mm-hmm. an American Marxism, but Marxism, right? And so that's the progressive left.
Give a brief description of what Marxism actually means, just for our audience.
So Marxism, for me, I want to speak about it as an economic approach and a mindset, okay? A personal mindset. So economically, Marxism is a complete faith, a strong, strong, abiding faith in government mm-hmm. to make decisions, intervene within the economy directly through regulations, through spending, its own spending, to determine economic outcomes, to make economic choices for us, to present us with the economic choices from which we may choose. Okay? And so it leads to single payer universal health care. Mm-hmm. Okay? It leads to free education, which of course is not free for
right.
all.
Of course it's not.
It leads to a guaranteed income for all, as we're hearing now today. Let's dive into these and the reasons that I have deep skepticism of all those ideas in a future session. But you asked me what Marxism is. It's those ideas with that philosophy. That's right. The philosophy is
government. Marxism is slavery to the state. Fuck it.
I love the interjection from the crowd. Hey, security, security.
That's what it is. It's slavery to the state.
Well, it is
slavery to the state.
It is denial of the dignity and soul of the individual. Mm-hmm. That's what it is.
Wow.
And it is a rejection of the idea that we can, as messy as it is, as many mistakes as we make, as flawed as we are, that over the medium and long term, we will make the best decisions that we can. Now, Marxism is a reduction of human inspiration, want, and need to material things.
I understand.
And so it's redistribution of material things that is the Marxist program. Derek, here's when I was younger, late high school, past college, even after my visit to the Soviet Union, which the vision of Lenin resonated with me. The vision of Marx resonated and resonates with me. Mm-hmm. But the methods don't work.
The methods don't work.
The 20th century is proof that the methods don't work. Venezuela today, the methods don't work.
You know, some of your points here, okay, now these are constant themes, and this is the stuff that draws my attention, and I think it's going to draw the attention of a lot of people. Once they let it resonate, think about things such as, you know, more respect. Libertarians are we don't want to use the word fighting. They're pushing for respect, your own personal respect and liberties to make your own decisions. So we're talking about, and I've had these conversations with every last libertarian that's sat in one of these chairs, and each one of them says the same things. You know, illegal drugs, make them legal. A lot of people will hear that. They're out there, they'll hear that.
Some.
Make some of them legal.
I'm too close to the opioid epidemic and
with that being said, do you think our society, and this is just an honest question.
Yep, go with it.
You know, do you think our society is really ready for that? What kind of change, what kind of, you know, magnitude of change would that be for our society as it is, how we under the U.S. society? Because remember everybody, these rules and regulations that we abide by or try to or violate, okay, are only taking place here in the United States. Outside of the United States, things are different. Other things are legal. Some things that are legal here, you know, aren't legal there, or vice versa. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it's, you know, we're talking about the United States of America right now. That's what we're talking about.
Yes,
are we ready with some, like you said, the opioid, you know, epidemic that's going on right now? Are we ready to make some of these drugs legal?
So decriminalize cannabis. I think we're ready for that.
Yeah.
I think that
it's slowly happening. The cannabis that, you're right, that's being decriminalized. But guess what? There's still a lot of people locked up in our correctional facilities and institutions for marijuana charges.
Well, I, that's true, but But there's some nuance about that too. Mm-hmm. Remember that when individuals allegedly commit crimes and they go through the criminal justice process and system, there's a negotiation that occurs. Mm-hmm. The negotiation is between
judge, lawyer, prosecutor, attorney.
You got it. And there's back and forth about what an individual may or may not have done and what we can and can't prove, right? And a lot. Let's just say at least some, okay? I'll go to many. When you see somebody who is in jail and the charge on the record is marijuana, mm-hmm. I'm not saying always here, I'm saying there's nuance. In many cases, it was that's where the negotiation ended, at the lowest charge, right? The least serious charge.
Right.
Right? It could have gone something different, but the way the everybody decided that, all things considered, that which was most just in this case mm-hmm. was marijuana possession kind of. Now, with that nuance said, right?
Right.
Let's decriminalize cannabis. I also want to say something that I know my libertarian family would agree with, but sometimes they forget. I don't hear them say, mm-hmm. which is that just as we've legalized alcohol, mm-hmm. right? Prohibition did not work, right?
Right.
We hold the individuals who consume alcohol responsible for their actions under the influence of alcohol.
Yes, we do.
And as a society, we have done a fantastic job over the last few decades. Since I was drinking as a teenager and was drinking too much, right? We have done a wonderful job that we should be proud of in this country against drunk driving.
Yeah, you know, it's gotten more strict, and I think that people understand that they don't want their freedoms taken away as quickly as it can be taken away by those who do indulge in drinking and driving and then get caught doing it.
Well, the problem is getting back to the libertarian, you can't do you things that put
some
others
kind of
at do harm,
some
right? You can't do harm or create a situation that any reasonable person would say is a situation of high risk of harm to somebody else.
Yes.
You can't be there like drunk driving, right? And just my little caveat or caution on decriminalization of cannabis is that it is not okay to be driving around high, right? Mm-hmm. Colorado is beginning to see accidents, severe accidents, and there's mm-hmm. and we need to figure out the right calibration there is all I'm saying. Individuals need to be accountable for their decisions.
Before I forget,
yes.
I do want you to tell everybody out there, again, we're talking with David Lasher. He's running
yes,
for Congress in the House of Representatives, and he's running in, is that District 3? District 3?
The highly gerrymandered, the second most gerrymandered yeah. district of the 435 in the United States. Yes, the third.
Yeah, and good luck.
Which is one of the things that makes it challenging.
Yeah, and I know it's tough. You know, you guys are running, you know, we talked before, it's an uphill battle.
I've got faith that if we have debate, if messages get out, the message, because it should resonate, will resonate, result in change.
If people want to reach out to you, maybe donate to your campaign or just ask you questions, do you have things in place, a website, Facebook page, IG, Twitter, all that stuff going?
I do.
And please let people know how they can find you.
I will. And I know we have to wrap up. But to wrap up, let me tie up one or two things that we left out there.
Sure, no, go ahead. We're good to go. As long as I haven't gotten the signal to shut it down yet, we're good to go.
Well, with respect to the audience, too, who doesn't want this to drag on, getting back to the Marxism, in my professional career, we didn't talk about it. I was a technology executive, and through
through putting in information technology solutions to solve problems in big companies and more recent in public agencies in Florida and here in Maryland, I became devoted to a very important question, two questions, three questions to that anybody should ask themselves when they're trying to figure out what to do about a problem. Mm-hmm. I got this from technology, but it applies to society and politics as well. And three questions, the basic breakdown is what versus how. What versus how? What are we seeking and how do we obtain it? Mm-hmm. Marx, Lenin, right? I abhor the methods of Lenin. Even more than I abhor what comes directly from the religion of Marxism can only be held through religious faith. Mm-hmm. To the what versus how, right?
Right.
The vision of Marx, making sure that working people have good opportunity and decent lives. Yeah, that what? Yes.
Yeah. It's important.
Yes. For the how? How to get that?
How to get that.
Marxism isn't the only way.
It's not the only way.
And what the 20th century teaches us is that the Marxist way of pursuing that goal, that what, doesn't work.
It doesn't work. It hasn't
It hasn't worked anywhere.
It hasn't worked. Nowhere.
Anywhere. So why here? And it won't. And it is devotion. It's a devotion to a worthy and compelling objective that I personally share. Mm-hmm. But what I've come to understand and believe is that we can't get there through an over-intervening despotic government. We can't get there. We have to trust one another. Mm-hmm. We get there through ourselves and collections of ourselves. Overseeing. I am not of the libertarian strain that says abolish government. I'm not an anarchist. But I am for a group. We need to stem the continuing reach of government. So what versus how is the point I'm trying to make?
Yeah, and no, I understand. It's a constant theme. I've been you guys all said so elaborately your own ways. It's amazing. Like I always tell Charles Wesley, I tell him all the time that. And he hears it, and yeah. I know he does.
Yeah.
But it always comes back, and that's as soon as it does, I pick up on it right away. It's given more power, but that's what the other parties are scared of. Well, what it sounds like, it's giving people too much power, and the sad part is they don't want to give that power to you as an individual,
to make your own
decision as an individual, because they believe that they know better. What's better for you, as a community, they'll break it down to culture, they'll break it down to age,
yes,
demographics.
Sir. Yep, you're right.
Yeah, I know because I'm learning from you guys. You know, I'm not just sitting here, you know, interviewing you and all the people that come into the studio. It's I hear and I say, you know what? That makes sense. And guess what? Whether we like it or not, there are a lot of people that are perfectly fine with that kind of governing over their lives. What are you going to do about them? What about the people that rebel and say, no, that was fine? There's people out there that say, no, I need more of this. I need more welfare. I need that. You know, I don't live in a community like
help,
you live.
Help
in,
yes,
in
opportunity
Reisestown.
Yes, but help yes, opportunity yes, but.
What do you put those people? What happens to them?
We help them achieve. We help them overcome whatever demons they may be afflicted with. Addiction is a serious problem, mm-hmm, that we don't talk enough about and don't do enough about. Mental illness, mental health, behavioral health are more serious problems than people realize and than we're talking about, and we can do something there. We can create opportunity. We can talk in a future time about
sure.
my aha moment on opportunity up in Rochester, New York, that I learned about in the city there, in Rochester, when I worked for Xerox. We can talk about that. But what versus how, we should always be asking ourselves that, and the what we share, the how we differ on, and if we can recognize that we share what we're trying to, mm-hmm. to achieve, we can begin to get some relief from this hysteria that's prevailing all around us on all sides of the political, both sides of the political spectrum, and is in, I think it's aggravated and fomented by those in the media who, you know, what do they ultimately want? Are they really searching for truth, or are they really trying to build audience?
They're trying to build audience.
I'm not saying they're bad people, right? But let's recognize that they're trying to build audience, right? And
sure.
And create controversy and stoke controversy, because that
it brings gets viewers.
It gets them their audience.
It brings viewers.
We need to settle down, right?
Let's say this is your opportunity. You're speaking to thousands of people. You look out at them, and you have a single message. You know, what is that message to the populace? What do you say to them to get them to believe in you, believe in the not just you, but the libertarian movement, and maybe even possibly convert some people just by, you know, your statements. What do you say to people?
We all need to recognize each other's fundamental humanity and dignity, and recognize that, though it doesn't seem so quite often these days, we really all do want the same thing, a better America. We really do have broad agreement on what we want, and the debate we need is about how to get there, and we need to respectfully listen to each other's different ideas about the question of how. That's what my campaign is about. I think that's what libertarianism is about.
I love it. That well done. Well
Thank
said.
You.
Well said. And, you know, please give them some kind of contact information. You know, if you guys look here, David Lasher, he's got elegant flyers here. He's a great guy. He's got a very important message that all of us need to hear. Again, there's nowhere to hide. There's nowhere to hide from this. This affects all of us, whether you think it does or not. So again, David Lasher for Congress, you know, look him up, look up the libertarian movement, learn something, find out about what's going on in the world, and there is something that you can do about it. You know, don't feel isolated. Don't feel as though you don't play a part or you can't contribute to change, right?
That's right. I want to leave with a message of hope before finally getting to a little bit of contact information. Pre-show, I've learned that's the word.
Yeah.
Pre-show, we were talking about a meeting that I had the opportunity to join last week in East Baltimore, and it was a small meeting of five candidates for U.S. Senate and for U.S. Congress, three Democrats, one Republican, and myself, a Libertarian. The Democratic candidates, I think two of them we would say are progressive, one I would say is more traditionally liberal, maybe two were liberal perhaps. So the point being representative of different views within the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm.
And the Republican you've had on the show here, Liz, also very interesting because she's also, she's on her own political journey of intellectually and emotionally. Well, the five of us came together, views, different skin colors, and we different political ideas about how to bring about a bit. We spent an hour together. We had a great conversation. We kept the focus on where we agreed. We respectfully disagreed with each other.
Sure. Which is healthy, by the way.
I believe, I can't speak for the four others, but I think that I made four friends that day.
Yeah, yep.
If we could do that in East Baltimore last week, mm-hmm. why can't we do that 40 miles away in Washington, D.C., in the Congress, with change through the elections, starting in 2018 and doubling down in 2020? Why not? We can.
I believe
the audacity of hope. Barack Obama.
I love the message. I really just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being here. I also want to invite you back and leave arms open and the door open, of course, for you to come back here in TV Free Studios with us for another follow-up. The political season is still going. It seems like it's pretty deep within the election cycle, however that works.
Well, we just had the primary today, yeah, right? For the major parties, the Republicans and Democrats.
Everywhere I look, everywhere I was today, everywhere I've been, I see people standing on corners. They're waving. There are banners everywhere, and it must be getting tight. Numbers are coming in, and so I'm not up to speed enough to really know who's looking good and who's not.
I'm actually not either.
But it's going to get real interesting here soon. So
it will.
To have you back and have a lot of our previous guests back in the studio to talk about what's going on. That's going to be something that we're going to focus on doing here. So
I look forward to it, and maybe I'll try to bring one or more of my new four friends from last week too. I mean, some discussions from some different viewpoints, civil discussions. Right?
And I really appreciate you. I like the fact that you're not rushing this interview, and we all have stuff to do, and I'm pretty sure you have other places and other things.
I have a daughter to get back to.
Right, but
and a wife.
What I love about this interview is, you want to say what needs to be said. You want to make sure that it's being heard. And a lot of times, what I get from these other politicians when I see them and I hear them, it's all the same jargon, it seems like, all the time. It's it's refreshing to me, personally. And again,
yep.
I'm just speaking for myself here, ladies and gentlemen. Because I have my own perspectives and my own views, just like you guys out there. So when you actually learn something and you hear something different, embrace it. You want to embrace that. You want to take the time. It's not about, this is the problem, that this is what you were talking about, what happened over in East Baltimore. Mm-hmm. You get people with different viewpoints, and you don't have to agree on everything, but there's a respect level that's generated. And if everybody's ultimately got the same, overall agenda, or final,
the what,
then why not work with people who are on the same accord? It's a no-brainer. You would think so. So, and again, I just want to thank you for taking the time out to come to the station. Was there anything else that you wanted to say before we in this particular interview?
No, I really enjoyed it, Derek. Enjoyed meeting with you, being with you. Look forward to coming back, and appreciate the very kind words at the close there.
Sure.
And if folks do want to read a little bit more and see the videos that I have created to learn a little bit more about me, more important, my campaign and the ideas that my campaign is trying to advance, the website is www.lasher2018.us.
Mm-hmm.
Lasher is spelled with an A-R, L-A-S-H-A-R, not an E-R.
Yeah.
Facebook page for the campaign page is www.facebook.com/Lasher2018. And then for the videos, there's a YouTube channel that doesn't have enough subscribers yet to have a nice URL. But if you go to my website or you go to my Facebook page, you can see the videos. I'm getting good response from them. They talk about some of what we've talked about here, and talk about some other things. And Derek, just to close, that I don't know if I will win or not.
Right.
I think I can. For reasons we've discussed, I think I should, or else I wouldn't be in the race. But what I'm really excited about and passionate about, the reason I'm doing this is I feel I went through a journey emotionally and intellectually over the last 2 or 3 years that I think other people, even if they don't arrive where I arrived through that journey, I think that our times being what they are, which is, I don't like saying it that way. I think that our society has changed. I think that the two parties aren't the right model for us anymore. Right. And I think that people need to engage that question and ask themselves whether that's so or not for them. If so or not so, why? That's what this campaign is about, raising that question and helping people through it, and wherever they land on the question.
Yeah, well said. And we can end on this note. And think about this. You know, we've come this far as a civilization due to and through evolution. What makes you guys, or what makes anybody think that evolution has stopped or is going to stop? So you guys take that one and think about it. And can I have this? I want to throw one more point of contact for Mr. Lasher out there, because I do have the flyer here. And if you would like to email.
Please do. Go ahead.
You can email Mr. Lasher at campaign.
David will work. David at.
David at.
I should either or.
You got.
Does this one
work though? Still.
Go ahead.
So that's campaign. The word campaign. CAMPAIGN at the at symbol, Lasher2018.us. Okay. So feel free to give him an email. Send him a message. You know, state your business. Say, you know. Hopefully you'll be emailing him to tell him that you're actually voting for him this coming election. That's what you want to state in the email. So thanks again
for
coming in for this interview. We will have Mr. Lasher back in the TV Free Studios with us again. And this has been another episode of Maryland Politics here at TV Free Baltimore. And thank you guys for viewing. We'll catch you next time. Have a good night.
You're watching Maryland Politics here on TV Free Baltimore.
Hi. Hi. I'm Dawn Wells, and guess what? You are watching TV Free Baltimore.
Seven Principles of Libertarianism by Alex Merced. Self-ownership, the idea that you own yourself and your body and your property. Non-aggression. The idea that no one should initiate force on you or your property. Voluntarism, the idea that arrangements and institutions in society are based on voluntary participation. Free exchange, the idea that individuals are free to exchange their property in the arrangements they see fit. Decentralization, the idea that centralized power is easily corruptible and more dangerous, so that power should be decentralized through a market process instead of centralized through a political process. Property rights, the idea that society should have well-defined definitions of what is property and protect the individual's right to own property. Individualism, the idea that all individuals have equality of rights and that should not be punished or privilege at the cost of another because some abstract association with the idea of a group. Learn more about libertarianism by subscribing to the following podcasts: The Alex Merced Cast, The Tom Woods Show, Lions of Liberty, The Johnny Rocket Launchpad, The Jason Stapleton Program, The Remzo Republic. Also, check out these websites: Fee.org, Mises.org, Cato.org, Reason.com, LibertarianWingMedia.com and TheLibertarianRepublic.com. My name is Alex Merced. Subscribe to my podcast, The Alex Merced Cast, and like me on Facebook at facebook.com/AlexMercedLP.
Two thousand years ago, there may not have been liberals as we think of them today, but some of the dumb ideas that underpin the whole ideology were floating around. Fortunately, in Greece, some of the greatest minds in human history were there to set people straight. There are an awful lot of liberals who could benefit from reading these more than 2,000-year-old words of wisdom. 1. The real destroyer of the liberties of the people is he who spreads among them bounties, donations, and benefits. Plutarch. 2. When you're offended at any man's faults, turn to yourself and study your own failings. Then you will forget your anger. Epictetus. 3. The worst form of inequality is to try to make unequal things equal. Aristotle. 4. Justice means minding one's own business and not meddling with other men's concerns. Plato. 5. Toil is no source of shame. Idleness is shame. Hesiod. 6. Good people do not need laws to tell them to act responsibly, while bad people will find a way around the laws. Plato. 7. We hang the petty thieves and appoint the great ones to public office. Aesop. 8. The most virtuous are those who content themselves with being virtuous without seeking to appear so. Plato. 9. When there is an income tax, the just man will pay more and the unjust less on the same amount of income. Plato. 10. Our object in the construction of the state is the greatest happiness of the whole and not that of any one class. Plato. 11. Knowledge becomes evil if the aim be not virtuous. Plato. 12. This and no other is the root from which a tyrant springs. When he first appears, he is a protector. Plato. 13. Those who have virtue always in their mouths and neglected in practice are like a harp, which emits a sound pleasing to others while itself is insensible of the music. Diogenes. 14. We praise a man who feels angry on the right grounds and against the right persons, and also in the right manner at the right moment and for the right length of time. Aristotle. 15. We regard wealth as something to be properly used, rather than as something to boast about. As for poverty, no one need be ashamed to admit it. The real shame is in not taking practical measures to escape from it. Pericles. 16. Republics decline into democracies, and democracies degenerate into despotisms. Aristotle. 17. Only the dead have seen the end of war. Plato. 18. The curse of me and my nation is that we always think things can be bettered by immediate action of some sort, any sort, rather than no sort. Plato. 19. Society is well governed when its people obey the magistrates, and the magistrates obey the law. Solon. And 20. A system of morality which is based on relative emotional values is a mere illusion, a thoroughly vulgar conception which has nothing sound in it and nothing true. Socrates. The preceding editorial was written by John Hawkins. More of his work may be found at rightwingnews.com. Please forward a link to this eye-opening video to others. Thank you.
Why am I a black conservative? Well, when I was 9, my family lived in the projects of Baltimore. It was a brand new 11-story high-rise building. Everything was new. 99% of the folks who lived there were black. Within 6 months' time, I watched that building turning into a huge ghetto. Now, these folks had free everything. Free housing, free food, free health care. And yet, the projects were the violent, angry place to live. The only thing that saved me was that in 1956, my father was one of the first blacks to break the color barrier into the Baltimore Fire Department. So that gave us funds to move out of the projects. But the bulk of my family, they stay there. And they lived on government their whole life. I had a cousin who was 40 years old, never had a job in his life. I said, come on, Ronald, I know you had a paper route when you were 10. No, never. And everything that we attempted to get them off of the welfare, they said, oh, no. I don't want to stop my check. I don't want to do anything from getting my check. And know what? They had no self-esteem. Well, duh, because self-esteem comes from personal achievement. But when you're sitting on your butt all day, you ain't gonna have no self-esteem. So when I heard Democrats talk about how much compassion they have for the poor, I felt like, gag me. Just gag me, you lying scumbags. How do you really feel, Lord? No, look, I feel like that because I watch people totally dependent on government. I watch it destroy their lives, destroy their spirits. And now Barack Obama wants to do that same thing to our whole country. 47% of the country is getting food stamps. That's almost half the country on food stamps. That's bad, folks. That's bad, it's scary, it's wrong, and it's evil. It's evil because it stops you from being the best that you can be. My cousins were so talented in so many ways, but they never pursued their talents. And they just lived miserable lives. And something else too, the bulk of my cousins are dead. Alcohol abuse, AIDS, jail. Why? Because the Bible says an idle mind is a devil's workshop.
Oh, I love this town. I love the people. Hello, Baltimore.
Hello.
On this earth, there is no equal. Hello, Baltimore. I love the cracks. How about them O's? The heat in the summertime. Strolling through the neighborhoods simply feels sublime. I love this town, I love those people. Hello, Baltimore.
Hello.
On this earth there is no equal. Hello, Baltimore. I meet you at the harbor, it's no bother. The trolley will do just fine. We work every day, then go out to play. Hey, hon, let me get you more wine. Beautiful.
Hello, Baltimore.
It's the land of pleasant living.
Hello, Baltimore.
So if you wanna stay for more than just a day, it's the city we adore. And by the way, I just have to say, hello.
They use their media to assassinate real news. They use their schools to teach children that their president is another Hitler. They use their movie stars and singers and comedy shows and award shows to repeat their narrative over and over again. And then they use their ex-president to endorse the resistance, all to make them march, make them protest, make them scream racism and sexism and xenophobia and homophobia, to smash windows, burn cars, shut down interstates and airports, bully and terrorize the law-abiding, until the only option left is for the police to do their jobs and stop the madness. And when that happens, they'll use it as an excuse for their outrage.
The only way we stop this, the only way we save our country and our freedom, is to fight this violence of lies with the clenched fist of truth. I'm the National Rifle Association of America, and I'm freedom's safest place.
We also gave those who wished to destroy space to do that as well. We also gave those who wished to destroy space to do that as well. We also gave those who wished to destroy space to do that as well. We also gave those who wished to destroy space to do that as well. We also gave those who wished to destroy space to do that as well.
4 years ago, people were fleeing Maryland. 43 tax hikes, even taxing the rain. 100,000 jobs lost. So we elected Larry Hogan. $1.2 billion in tax toll and fee relief. Highest ever funding for schools. Healthiest Bay in a generation. Maryland's back. When we needed a leader, Hogan was there. And when he needed us, we returned the favor. Larry Hogan, changing Maryland.
My name's Tony Campbell, and I approve this message. If you want the end of Common Core, if you want to protect our children, if you want a balanced budget in Washington, D.C., if you want to protect our veterans and make sure they get the care that they need, if you also want to end chain migration and a diversity lottery, then I'm your candidate for United States Senate. My name's Tony Campbell. I'm a Republican for United States Senate, paid for by Campbell for Maryland.
You're watching TV Free Baltimore.
My name is Bob Cocky, and I need your help. I'm running for the state delegate seat in the Maryland 12th Legislative District. I'm not a politician, and I'm not a lawyer. Annapolis has enough of those. It's time that we separate and put party politics aside and work as one big team. We've got some serious problems facing us. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that I'm against crime, I'm against high taxes, I'm against the opioid problem. Of course I am, but they're just catchphrases for other politicians. What I want to tell you is that on February the 9th, I got up, I grabbed a tie and a jacket, and I put it on. My wife said, "Where are you going, Bob?" I said, "I'm going to go apply for a job." She said, "What?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Where?" I said, "Annapolis." This is a true story, by the way. I'm not making this up. She said, what job are you going to apply for?" I said, "I'm going to apply for the House of Delegates." I said, "Enough is enough. I'm tired of sitting back watching. I'm going to take part in this." She says, "You don't have a chance, Bob." I said, "Well, we'll see. We'll see." What I want to tell you is we have to run our government like you run your household. We have a budget. We have to stick to it. We just can't keep raising taxes. I know what it's like as a small businessman. We have a flat tire the same day your gas and electric bill comes in. When the governor says we need an inspector general to see where the money's going into Baltimore City, he's 100% right. By being smart stewards of the money that we have, we can all have new schools. We can have programs to help children and adults with special needs. I guess I might want to say that I'm on a platform of a level playing field. And I don't just mean race. I don't just mean religious backgrounds. I'm talking about a level playing field in every section. What's good for Glenelg and Howard County is good for Elk Ridge. What's good in Towson is also good for Lansdowne. We all pay the same taxes. We should all reap the same benefits. 20 to 30% cost overruns in government contracts, whether it's in a school system, whether it's in building a road, has become a common everyday practice. Another thing we have to watch out for is, I spent all day in Annapolis a couple weeks ago. They were trying to get a bill through called the SAFE Act, and that was just a disguise to make Maryland a sanctuary state. Listen, I'm not against immigrants. This country was built on immigrants. But what I am in favor of is legal immigrants, and it's not fair to the immigrants that came here through the legal process. Our immigrants built this country, and they're still a big part of what goes on in this country. America is a great country, and that's why everybody wants to come here. But we have to pay attention to what's going on. We need to decide who our real heroes are, and by smart financial responsibility, we can pay our teachers, our firefighters, and our policemen what they deserve. They're our real heroes, not somebody that catches the ball. Let's get real with this, okay? I'm not just new to this area. The Cockey family came to Maryland in 1676. I've lived in the 12th District for over 32 years. I've umpired Little League games. My wife retired from the system in education after 30 years. My son is a volunteer firefighter at the Elk Ridge Fire Department. So we're not new to this area. I love the state of Maryland, and that's why I'm getting involved. Whether you vote for me or if you vote for someone else, I need you to vote. We need to wake up and get involved and see what's going on in our state. Thank you. My name is Bob Cockey. Visit me on my website, Elect Bob Cockey, or visit my personal Facebook page. It's not a political Facebook page. You can see what I've been doing and talking about for the last several years on my personal Facebook page. On the election ballot, my personal phone number is on there, my cell phone. You don't have to go through any voicemails. You'll call me directly. Thanks for listening to my message.
In March 2016, our county executive, Kevin Kamenetz, announced a settlement of litigation. Baltimore County residents apparently stood accused of serious human rights violations. So serious that Kamenetz committed to spend $30 million to subsidize developers of affordable housing, and committed us to relocate over 2,000 dependent households to nice suburban neighborhoods with high-performing schools, regardless of the costs. And so, with a stroke of his pen, Towson became the epicenter of the largest public housing relocation experiment in the United States, without so much as a vote by county council on this deal. And if you even just asked what Baltimore County did wrong, what we were accused of, you would find no answer. No record of the original complaint, no press release from the group suing us, no public record of 4 years of litigation. Over 10,000 pages of case details exempt from the Freedom of Information Act. This was done in secret for a reason, because it was intended to subvert democracy in Baltimore County, to bypass county council, and to impose a far-reaching agenda without any public input. And because the arguments against us would not have withstood public scrutiny, at least not outside of the secret proceedings of this biased HUD court. And because this plan is engineered to ignore the concerns of the communities it targets, regardless of any harm it may cause them. But really, at its core, because the more information is made public, the dirtier this deal looks. County residents had no notice, no right to confront our accusers, no say in the settlement terms imposed on us, which now, by design, can never be modified by our elected representatives, even though most of this deal's costs are scheduled for after Kamenetz leaves office. Let's call this what it was, a betrayal of Baltimore County residents. But Kamenetz was not alone in that betrayal. While these special interests were suing Baltimore County taxpayers, Towson's representative, Delegate Steve Lafferty, was actually on the side of the people suing his constituents. Lafferty is the author and lead sponsor of their top legislative priority, giving them unchecked quasi-governmental power to move thousands of people around Baltimore County like dots on a map. Lafferty's bill would change state law to make this sort of abusive litigation even easier in the future. Not even Kamenetz would go that far, handing unaccountable power to a group of hostile special interests who answer to no elected officials. Maybe this is why, when the settlement was announced, these activists confidently stated that 2,000 households and $30 million was merely a first step. We know their agenda includes forcing Towson to build public housing projects, so we'd be wise to take that statement seriously. Defending democracy against a cabal of special interests, seeking unaccountable power over local communities, should not be controversial. It should not be partisan. And at a local level, it wasn't. By a 6-1 bipartisan vote, Baltimore County Council resoundingly rejected Lafferty's plan. So Lafferty responded by partnering with D.C. area Democrats in the state legislature to override the will of his county's locally elected representatives. Towson residents had no say in Kamenetz's dirty deal, but we will have a choice in 2018.
Hi, I'm Steve McIntyre, and I'm running for the House of Delegates, because Towson deserves a representative who actually represents the people who call its communities home, not some partisan agenda or some extreme ideology, and absolutely not some band of special interests who seek to impose their plans on our communities. What happened here is wrong. It really should be a national scandal. But there's a lot more of this story yet to come. This is the first episode in a series, and if you go to my website, stevemcintyre.org, sign up, I'll keep you updated on the latest. And of course, please share this with your friends and neighbors. This is important information. I don't make these statements lightly, but people of Baltimore County deserve to know the truth. Anyway, thanks a lot for paying attention and, you know, considering the facts with an open mind. And I look forward to meeting you on the campaign trail. Thanks a lot and have a great day.
Hello, this is Mary from TV Free Baltimore. I'm here at Turkey Point Marina, and I'm here with Lenny Rudo. He has started a wonderful new magazine called Fish Talk. Would you like to tell some of the passion about why you have started this?
Sure. Well, you know, we anglers in the Mid-Atlantic region, and particularly in the Chesapeake, we care an awful lot about what's going on out there, and unfortunately, we've had no publication for years and years, really ever since the recession hit and several went out of business. We've had no publication covering fishing in this area, either in print or on the web. So we started Fish Talk, which is both in print and on the web. We started up in April of last year, so we're now publishing the 15th edition. This is last month. This is our newest right here with a big, beautiful black drum on the cover. Boy, I wish I caught him.
What areas are you mainly covering?
So we actually cover from Delaware clear down into Virginia. The Chesapeake Bay is where our heart is. It's where we're based at. But we also do cover the coastal fishing, Delaware, Maryland, Virginia. And we also cover freshwater in all three of those states, as well as D.C. and a little bit in Pennsylvania. It's really all the areas that any anglers living around here might want to go fish.
You keep us updated on the conditions and the amount of fish and all and other aspects of what's going on with the marina life and everything.
Absolutely. As far as the how-to, where-to information goes, we put it all right here in the magazine. This is your how-to, where-to. Now, of course, there's a time lag between when you prepare a magazine and when you actually print it. And that was always the weakness with fishing reports that appeared in any kind of print publication. So what we do is every week by noon on Friday, we update fishing reports that cover all the different areas that we just talked about. We have different reports for the Middle Chesapeake, for the Lower Chesapeake, for the Tangier Sound. All these areas, we call a bunch of folks in each different area. We talk to different charter boat captains, we talk to different tackle shops, and we get reports for all these different areas. Every Friday by noon, they're updated.
What is your mission?
You know what? It all boils down to helping you catch more bigger fish. That's what it all comes down to. We have a ton of how-to, we have a ton of where-to. If you fish in this area, you're going to find the tactics, you're going to find the techniques that you need to know to catch drum like that and speckled trout like that.
What's your contact information?
Well, you can always go to fishtalkmag.com, spelled just like it sounds, fishtalkmag.com, and that'll take you right to the magazine online. From there, you can find email. You can email me if you'd like. I'm always happy to get emails from readers. Send us reports. Send us your fish pictures. We have an entire section in the magazine of reader photos where readers have sent in different fish pictures of the fish that they've caught. And people love being in print, so you know it's fun.
Where can you get the print?
Well, the print version is available in over 700 locations up and down the Mid-Atlantic region. Pretty much all the tackle shops have it. Lots of marinas have it. It's right here at Turkey Point. They've got it inside at the office. A lot of convenience stores have it. And, of course, since we're, you know, talking to fishermen, the liquor stores all have it, too.
Oh, that's great. And the bait stores, right?
Absolutely.
And it's free?
It's completely free, yes. Please.
That's great.
Find a print version. Take one home with you.
Okay, everybody out there, go out and look for Fish Talk, and you'll become a great fisherman. It's Mary from TV Free Baltimore. Thank you so much.
We hope you're enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
Hello, this is Paul Stefan, and welcome to another episode of TV Free Baltimore's Movie Reviews. And today we're very lucky to have as our guest Baltimore's own prolific actor, Johnny Alonzo. Welcome, Johnny.
Hey, man. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm okay. It's been a long few days back in town, but I'm happy to be back.
You're the hardest working guy around.
It's hardest getting work, you know what I mean? So
yeah.
Yeah, it's a lifestyle.
Because right now, I mean, you have a lot of projects going on. I mean, right now, isn't this one The Clean Job?
Yeah. The mafia film.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about that for starters.
It's phenomenal. Phenomenal.
Being shot here?
Mainly in Washington, D.C.
Okay.
Yeah, Georgetown area.
Okay.
Yeah, in southeast Washington. Playing the character Ignacio, or Iggy.
Okay.
And he's stereotypical, you know, mobster, wise guy. Yeah. Comes from that type of family. And I can't give away too much because, like I said, we're Phil. Yeah, but just mix the romance from Goodfellas meets The Sopranos, mm-hmm. meets Godfather. You know, all the stereotypical.
Right.
And more, but it's a great story, and it's definitely going to take you on. It's going to put you on a wild ride.
Is this to be a feature film?
No, this is actually a short film.
Okay.
Which might be a a pitch.
Okay.
For like a Netflix series.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
That'd be good. Yeah. Like
another reason why the agent wanted me to do it.
So like a pilot sort of.
Yeah. Yeah. You make it. Yeah. It's kind of like a pilot, but not just for in-house. So
right.
If you make it a short film.
Right.
You can still submit it to film festivals.
Yeah, you can go, yeah, the festival circuit.
Yeah,
sure.
Man. Yeah, it's good.
Well, that's terrific. And then how about one I was really excited about, because I interviewed a lot of people on that film,
uh-huh.
Bill Tillman and the Outlaws.
Oh, yeah, that's great. The new Western film that we shot.
Yeah.
Directed by Wayne Shipley. Mm-hmm. He's a very good friend of mine, he and Patty. They're phenomenal.
Well, you've acted for him before.
Yes, in Day of the Gun.
Where
yes.
you played The Undertaker.
The Undertaker. What a cool role. To touch base on that, that was one of the hardest roles I ever had to play because, you know, as an actor, you kind of drive your force with dialogue. Mm-hmm. The Undertaker was like a Buster Keaton, Charlie Chaplin kind of character.
Oh, okay.
Which I had no dialogue, but I had to get my, you know, I had to interpret what they wanted physically and mm-hmm. with action. And it was not easy, man. So I just went over the top. And Wayne was like, whatever you're doing, keep doing it.
Oh, he liked
I was like, I don't know how much I got left, man. This is not easy. But he loved it, and it's one of my favorite clips on my demo reel that we sent out to casting in Los Angeles.
Does that give you a new respect for the old silent comedians like Keaton and Chaplin?
Absolutely. You know, I always say character actors, which I like to be considered, anyone can hold a gun and wear a suit, you know? Mm-hmm. It's what you got going inside it, man. So to do a character without any dialogue and to like kind of shine mm-hmm. Amongst actors in a scene that are incredible, you know, it's difficult, but that's my thing. I love being tested. I don't like being the smartest guy in the room. If I'm the smartest guy in the room, there's something wrong with that room.
Okay.
I've got to be tested. So okay. That's what I did with Day of the Gun, which got me into Bill Tillman and the Outlaws.
Well, great.
Yes.
Now, that movie, if you want to talk a little bit about that and sure. a little bit about your role, because yeah. Are you Big Joe?
I'm Big Joe.
You're Big Joe.
And this is how it's, yeah, I'm such a big guy. That's the joke of it all. There's Big Joe and Little Joe and Ma Darling, mm-hmm. who is played by the wonderful Lana Wood,
mm-hmm.
Natalie Wood's sister.
Sister, right.
Yeah, Lana was also a Bond girl. Mm-hmm. She was in Diamonds Are Forever.
With Sean Connery.
With Sean Connery. Well, yeah. Great. So, she was just awesome to work with. But yes, I played Big Joe. And Little Joe was played by a very good friend of mine, Patrick Boyer.
Okay.
He's like 6'5".
And you're how tall?
And I'm only 5'8".
Okay.
Yeah, so that was the whole joke of it all. I'm Big Joe and he's Little Joe. And but he respected me
mm-hmm.
as if I was the 6'5" brother.
Well, terrific.
Yeah, it's a great play on the names. And this film is it's a really cool classic cowboy western.
But it's about movies too.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
I mean, that's the thing is.
Yes.
Yes, it is. I had Ken Arnold in here, and we talked about it just before he started filming.
Yeah.
And I knew the character, Bill Tillman, the real person.
Sure.
Everybody in the audience should know Bill Tillman was a real guy.
Uh-huh.
And a real sheriff, a real badass sheriff.
That's right.
Who I think got more, you know, outlaws captured than anybody in the mm-hmm. Old West. He worked with Bette Masterson and Wyatt Earp in Dodge City.
Boy, you know your history. You should have been on our set.
I wanted to come, believe me.
You should have gotten in touch. I would have got you a pass, man.
Great, because I would have liked, because they said all kinds of people were going up there, because I mean, even one young lady, Alexis Barone, she had something to do with it. She had something to do with it, and she was going to try to get me in too. But I could, and I can't get Shipley in here yet, but I'd like to get him.
We'll get Wayne. I'll talk to him. Don't worry.
But anyway, it's about, you know, a sheriff, and he's they're talking about a film, because the real Bill Tillman did make a film about his old days.
Correct.
But the premise of this movie is
basically what you were just talking about. It's about a Californian director that comes into Bill Tillman's town and says he wants to shoot a movie about a bank robbery. But instead of using actors, he really wants to use the outlaws or the prisoners in Bill Tillman's jail. Mm-hmm. And I can't say too much about it.
Yeah, don't say much.
I don't want to spoil it.
But,
no, but it's very cool because, yeah, it's a film, it's a cowboy film about somebody making a film within the movie. And it's just, it's really, really cool. Lots of action, lots of gun, gunslinging, lots of horse riding. We had such a blast, man.
And it's, historic too, because Bill Tillman is not the only historical character that's being portrayed in that film.
No.
William Selig is being portrayed in the movie. I mean, there's
Bat Masterson.
There are all kinds of people that were in real life are being portrayed in this movie.
Yeah, well,
William S. Hart.
William S. Hart. There, I was just going to say that. God.
Robert, Johnny Crawford.
Yeah. Johnny Crawford was in it. I mean, just
the gun.
Robert Carradine.
One of the Carradine
Darby
brothers.
Darby Hinton. We had a great cast.
Yeah.
And to work with them for almost a month in Berkeley Springs, West Virginia, man, it was a cush job. We had such a blast, and the town just took us in as their own. And
that's terrific.
Yeah, I mean, we had a wonderful set. I mean, the little town, the western town that they built, looked like the set of Tombstone.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, you had the livestock, and you had the church, and you had the hardware store, and the blacksmith, and the houses. It was just something else, man.
But the thing for an indie, it almost seemed like a Hollywood movie, even just with the level of the cast that you got in this film, that I said, I knew this is something that's not going to be just a festival movie. I think it's going to get general release. Yep. It's going to be maybe even big, because not very many Westerns are made these days. And tell you, there's even fewer Westerns being made these days that aren't made by Clint Eastwood.
So true. you're absolutely right. And, One-Eyed Horse Productions, they're the ones that have put this together, the Shipleys and Company, with Dan Searles. I mean, Dan Searles is a phenomenal writer. He's the one that wrote Bill Tillman.
Oh, okay. Well, great to get him in here.
Yeah, you need to get him in. I'll get him in. I'll get everybody for you. Don't worry about
it. Okay, thanks, John.
You're welcome, man. You're welcome. But you're right. There aren't many Western pictures coming out. There are, but
this year I saw one was with Christian Bale.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I just saw that on Netflix.
One of the biggest one. In that was a 18 good one. So far.
Right. Okay. Yeah. But at this independent level, with these great names, and it's a character driven film, and it's a story that's driven by great actors, And like I said, we had a great time blasting off 20,000 rounds of ammo. So. You'll like it, man.
That's
like
a lot,
it.
I'm sure. And then, of course, one that you around and you were in just, I guess you already were in D.C. about or doing the D.C. premiere of What Death Leaves Behind.
Yes, What Death Leaves Behind, the premiere. I mean, well, we had the premiere in Philadelphia a couple months back, but we have a screening for it at the Miracle Theater in Washington, D.C. this Thursday.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. What's today? Is today Wednesday? Today's Tuesday.
Tuesday, right.
So 2 days from now.
If it's Tuesday, it must be Baltimore.
Yes.
Thursday, it's Washington.
Right.
You don't want it today anyway, because they're having the big Capitol celebration, the big parade.
Exactly. But What Death Leaves Behind is a super cool psychological thriller that we shot in Philadelphia through Smash Productions. And I was blessed to be a part of that cast, man.
And you played a bad guy, didn't you?
Real bad. Seriously sinister, super bad guy. It's kind of my brand, those rock and roll bad guys. My agent always says, and I always say this, it's better to be typecast and work every day than being typecast as a non-working actor.
Right.
Think about that. If you find your brand,
if
you find your brand and you work at it and you become the best, you'll get called. Because if you are an actor, you can always bounce in and out of it.
Well, it's good for you to think of that. Because, in old Hollywood, even the top stars pretty much had limited range. We only want to see Gary Cooper do this. We only want to see Cary Grant do that. That kind of stuff. That it's not a shame to say, you've been typed.
No. Why would I be ashamed? I mean, I bought a house and I got a couple cars, man. Give me a break. But I mean, as an actor, you know what you can do and what you're good at, right? Mm-hmm. But I also know as an actor that your job is to act. Mm-hmm. So if somebody asks me to do something that's like totally out of my reach or what I'm used to, well, then you give it a shot. That's what you're supposed to do.
Stretch yourself.
Absolutely, man. If you played by the rules, no one would ever have made it. I got my degree in acting at NYU, at the Actors Studio. And right out the gate, my first audition I booked was All My Children.
So that was your first professional job?
First professional job.
You got right in there.
And it's been downhill ever since.
Were you on there for like a year or what?
I was on there for almost a year, 64 episodes. Seth, yeah. Man, this guy's scaring me. I played Seth. I was Susan Lucci's nephew. 64 episodes. I worked with the likes of Sarah Michelle Gellar.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
Kelly Ripa.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, Matt Borlini. And great story. Sarah was just leaving the show when I was coming on.
Oh, okay.
And we became friends. And terrific. She was like, listen, I'm going to L.A., man. I said, I'll stay in touch. So a couple months into her Los Angeles trip, I gave her a call. I said, hey, how you doing? She's like, I'm fine. She goes, I hate L.A. I'm like, what's the matter? She's like, well, I've been auditioning, but I can't book anything. Mm-hmm. I was like, well, wow. What have you been auditioning? She's like, well, I'm on hold for this vampire pilot.
Okay.
Which turned out to be Buffy the Vampire Slayer. So she did really well, needless to say. You know, and Kelly Ripa was always sweet on set. And Matt Borlini was just—he was my boy. And so, it's been a good career.
Well, you mentioned Dan DeLuca, and he had done some great of that guy. Stuff, and I think Ken too, a little bit of soap opera stuff.
Yeah.
And I say, do you like them? Say you find that to be a great training ground for acting, because it's every day. You have to know your lines. It's 5 days a week. You know, it's intense.
Yeah. The answer is yes to all of the above. Yes, yes. It's the most grueling. I mean, when you were at my level, I had a lot of lines, right?
Yeah.
But I was still at the lowest part of the totem pole. I had to be I was one of the first people there and the last one to leave. They said, that's your deal. You haven't earned your stripes.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, you're there the entire day and you're freaking out about your dialogue because they don't give you a lot of grace. Mm-hmm. You know, TV and film timing are completely different.
Right.
Film timing, you can stretch it out a little bit. You can work with it. Television, if you have a 30-minute episode, this is as much time you have for your scene.
Right.
You better get it done. If not, you're getting clipped.
Right.
And Dan and Ken will tell you the same thing. It's grueling, but it's amazing. Amazing. It's an amazing way to work and hone your craft.
Great.
No question.
Now, what was your first movie?
What was my first, like, major motion? I think Serial Mom, maybe?
Serial Mom?
Yeah.
That really was the first
big. I think it was my first big break.
John Water.
Yes, he's a local. Friend of mine. Yes, local boy, right? I'm going to be seeing him this Saturday. I mean, yes, this Saturday in Los Angeles.
Well, I'm just saying, did you come to Baltimore and get the audition that
time? Yes. I came back from NYU, and I submitted to casting director Pat Moran.
Pat Moran, yes. I'm trying to get in here.
She's great.
I want to get her in here.
I haven't seen her in a long time.
Why don't you get a hold of her and tell her to come in here?
I should. I'll get her to come in here.
On
the phone. I
already sent her a message, but I haven't heard back yet.
Well, yeah. I guess, you know, I could because I can see that Dan, Ken, and myself have been here. Yeah. And she's had all of us. She's booked all of us. We owe a lot of thanks.
But I want to talk to her about things like, you know, when she used to act in Waters movies too.
Those were the days. But yes, man, Serial Mom, I think, was my first break into major motion. And then after that, it went over to Rules of Engagement. I remember working with Samuel L. Jackson on that.
It was great to be in the first one because, I mean, you got to work with Kathleen Turner.
Oh, she was great. My scene was at Hammerjacks, which is an old rock club in Baltimore.
Well, they're going to revive it again.
I heard they are. I heard. Yeah. And my scene was right out front of Hammerjacks, and Kathleen Turner's coming in. We have all our dialogue right before she comes into the club. And what a day that was, man.
I bet. Yeah, for a young guy, young actor.
I was on the seventh level. I was like, I can't let this go.
You can say this is the chick from Body Heat, you know?
Exactly. we all love that movie. You know?
And she went to the same college I went to, you know?
You know which one?
UMBC.
No, you're kidding me.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Get out
I
of
think
here.
She was just leaving as I came, or she might have been a senior when I was
That's so
freshman.
Cool. I didn't know that.
Yeah, because she was in the theater department there, yeah.
That's awesome.
Now, of course, you've done movies and TV. Have you done any stage?
Yes, I mean early in the day. I mean,
oh, not since.
I haven't had any time. I'd love to.
You want
to
do more?
Absolutely.
Regional or Broadway? Or
I would like to do off Broadway stuff if I could.
Off Broadway.
Yeah, but only because look, you know, I am a musician. Like I said, so I like to sing. Right. I do play instruments. My parents dance the Argentine tango. I dance the salsa, merengue, bachata, swing dance, all that. So we were brought up around the arts.
Terrific.
You know, I always tell people, my brothers and I. we, you know, our parents are doctors. So growing up, you know, in Howard Beach, New York, or coming back down here, my parents never had time to take us to like practice for football, baseball, lacrosse, right, whatever. But they just bathed us with like Marshall amps and drums and guitars and said, do your thing. We're not in the house anyway. Play as loud as you want. So that was, we became musicians and we got into the lively arts.
Yeah. Terrific.
Yeah, man.
Now, you're acting like, we'll say 20 years, 20 plus years.
Yeah.
What have you learned about the craft of acting in that time?
I've learned how to let go.
You think that's the biggest thing?
That's for me, because I know when I first started out, like anyone else, you know, when you are kind of like that private ranking amateur, mm-hmm, you tend to say, I've got to do it this way. I've got to be very rigid. You know, I got to say it a certain way. That's not acting. That's being a parrot, mm-hmm, you know? To being able to let go and to listen to a good director and trust their judgment. I've also learned that you make the director's job and the producer's job a lot easier if you kind of have an idea of what you're going to look like on camera. They say, okay, listen, this is how I want the scene. And they're telling you and they're describing it to you, and the camera's pointed like this one right here. It's pointed in front of me. I already know what I'm going to look like.
Yeah.
If I know that if I feel good about the way I look and the way I'm acting, I can guarantee the director is going to be feeling the same way too. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not gelling and if you're not vibing with that certain look, certain image, certain attitude, it falls apart. So I've learned how to almost create, well, in front of the camera, but know what's happening behind the camera. Kind of get a general sense of how it's going to look.
Right.
But like I said, letting go was the biggest thing.
That's good.
Yeah.
And how do you prepare for a role?
I'm one of those guys, if you can't tell, I have a lot of energy. And I have ADD. So I have to, my memory is the worst. So I have to read and read, and I read it over and over and over and over and over until they say action. Yeah. I nonstop reading. Okay. But I don't just memorize my dialogue. I memorize everyone else's on the page.
Wow.
That's just how I am. That's just how I work. For some reason, it's my curse.
So not just the cue to for you to start talking, the last thing they say.
I know their monologue before mine. And
there you go.
That's why I can't sleep. I don't know, man. But, you know, it's not an easy thing. But that's my method. And
that's your way of...
That's my way of doing it.
Getting into a role. Now... Or, you know, Hollywood and anything, in movies, TV, it's a business.
Yes.
And how would, or advice you might give to people who are interested in it, how they break into the business, how they can get a role. I mean, you know, because I know you've said before, like especially with Don and Marty, that you think that your job is not as an actor, but going to auditions.
Absolutely. That's one of my favorites. Man, you're good. You got all my information. I mean, I don't even have anything else to say.
But talk about that. You can expand on it because it's your life.
I can. I always tell, because, you know, people still come up to me and they say, you know, my kid, you know, I'd like to put them in something. How do I start? I don't know where to begin. I always tell them this. Classes. Mm-hmm. I'm not joking. Training. Like anything else. If you want to be a doctor, you got to go to school, right?
Of course.
Yeah, if you want to be a lawyer, you got to learn. Everybody thinks that they can act. Yeah, you can act to a degree, but, you know, but if you can't take direction, if you can't let go, if you can't see what the director's mind's eye is, what they're trying to get, and meet in the middle somewhere, forget it. You're not acting, mm-hmm, you know? Classes, training from reputable, you know, teachers. Sometimes a school. I mean, kids, you know... Yeah, you can take classes in school, you know, for older, you know, adults or what have you. I always say just go to a reputable coach, because there's always going to be a student in the class that's going to know more than you, mm-hmm, and who's been doing it for a while, and they say, hey, you know, I'm with this agency. And then you just start soaking up the network, you know. Always be humble. Yeah, you know, always just be cool, man, you know, just be cool. Don't act any bigger than you are. There's no need to.
Right.
Yeah, it's going to happen. You know, I'm a 300-year-old vampire, man, you know? What do I have to prove? You know, just do it, you know, and enjoy yourself and find yourself. Know who you are. Mm-hmm. That's another thing, too.
Yeah.
If you know that you're insecure, great. Okay. Either let it work for you or it's going to burn you. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't get in this business to fail. You get in this business to win. So you find a way to go forward. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to be your only you are your only cheerleader in this industry. Mm-hmm. You know, you can find others that cheer you on, but you have to be your biggest cheerleader. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm a very positive person. I've never had any problems with rejection.
Yeah,
it's another thing too, man. You know, if you hate being rejected, step aside. Do not get in this industry.
I would say that, you know, with acting, a lot of it is all about rejection. You know,
all of it. I mean, all of it. Yeah, and even the choices that you want to bring on set. No, that's wrong. Take this direction, because what you're doing is absolutely wrong. But you have to have your guns filled with something, you know? So my advice to actors always that are starting out, training, and a want and a belief. That's it, man.
Now, would you tell people to get an agent or a rep?
Yeah, you know, when you're ready. You don't want to go out there with an agent because you got a great look, and then all of a sudden you go out there and then you fail miserably at your first audition. What if that audition's with a great casting director? She's never going to call you in again. Mm-hmm. First impressions are everything, you know? The audition starts the second you walk into the waiting room. Because,
yeah.
I mean, I do a lot of casting in L.A., mm-hmm. and I will see some really bitchy actors in the waiting room, and then they come into the casting, and they're sweet as pie. Mm-hmm. Get out of here. Come on, man. I don't want you on set. That's how you're going to be, you know? So it starts the second you walk in. That's what I said. Be humble. Have humility. Just be cool, man. Because it's not an easy industry. It's not. No. People will drag your name through it. You know, they'll try to drag you through it if they're inferior. But if casting and other, you know, big names, producers know that that is not you, mm-hmm. they're not going to listen. You know, there's so much stacked up against you out there. So you just keep your head low and you just learn the business. Mm-hmm.
Be yourself, be genuine. Because like you're saying, somebody who might be bit you while they're waiting and they try to be sweet and ingratiate themselves with you as a casting director, you know they're phony. Exactly. And phoniness will show itself on the screen.
Without question. That's exactly it, man. Like I said, let go. That's the biggest thing in acting, man. Just let go, man.
Well, that's important.
Yeah, dude.
I mean, so are there anything else you'd like to bring up at this point? What's going on and anything else going down the road for you at this point?
Yeah, Riddle House.
That Riddle House, yeah.
That Riddle House.
And like
House.
I said, that maybe this summer
we'll
do a Skype interview with you.
That's
and
what
cast
I want us
members.
That's what I want us to do, man. You know? So I'm
with
producing
Shannon
that.
Shannon Elizabeth.
Yes. We have her on the docket. Tracy Faraway, my favorite person in the world.
Right, exactly.
Been talking to a lot of people, man, in this project. It's been a year in the making.
And you're the producer.
I'm one of the producers, yes.
Wow.
And I'm playing one of the leads.
A production credit before?
I have, as associate producer on Coffin 2.
Okay.
I'll also be getting associate producer, I think, on Coffin 3, if they let me.
Right.
So, you know. but yeah, I have a producer credit in Riddle House. I have a piece of the action. And
great.
Riddle House will also be a franchise. Holy, I'll be able to retire after Coffin 3 and Riddle House 2. That's
how
that's
great.
At.
I mean, because, but you're not like some people. I mean, because, you know, let's just say you're not considered A-list.
No, so A-minus is what my agent calls me.
Because you don't have your own production company.
No.
Or just saying, I'm Johnny Alonso, the film will get made.
Yeah, no.
You don't get greenlighted.
No. If anything, I'm Johnny Alonso. They go, oh, really? We don't want to see that movie. No. I've learned that you just work. That's my father's ethic. Just work.
Yeah.
Just work, man. Just work. And, you know, if that time comes, great. Where I have that kind of credibility and that strength that if my name's on a box, that it'll, you know. I mean, I won't lie to you. Yes, when I was on One Tree Hill, that fan base grew up with me.
Yeah.
So, you know, being in, like, Coffin, they recognize my name because a lot of those people like that kind of horror, psychological thriller kind of movie. Yeah. Being on Gotham, I have my own fan base. But I don't have that fan base that others do, you know? I'm happy where I am, man.
Well, you, so
it's hard enough as it is, you know?
You don't say, man, I want to carry a picture. I want to be a star. No, I want to be one of those big people. I want an Oscar. I don't know.
I have a hard enough time just hanging out in public, you know, because, you know, you kind of get pulled left and right. And when you do get, you know, somebody says, oh, weren't you in such and such? Weren't you the host of NASA 360? Weren't you in this movie?
Oh.
You know, stuff like that. It gets tiring because, you know, you want to be nice to everybody.
Yeah.
And I'm a nice guy to begin with. At least I think I am.
Okay.
And, you know, I don't want to say no to them. But if there are 30 people in front of you that want to shake your hand and talk to you, and you give 1 minute, 2 minutes to each, that's an hour of your time.
I know.
And it gets really tiring. So I feel bad for celebrities. I feel really bad for A-listers because they can't do anything.
No, they have no private life.
Zero.
Can't go to the grocery store, anything.
No, I can still get a Jack Daniels at this Lansdowne Bar, whatever it's called out here. You know, it's no problem.
Inn.
Yeah, exactly. I have no problem walking into a bar still. It's cool.
We'll have you maybe come over with us after the interview.
That sounds fine, you know? I could use one. But that's what I'm saying, man. It's like, you know, I enjoy my life. You know, I like to snowboard. I like surfing. I like skateboarding. You know, I like, you know, I like playing rock and roll and, you know, shooting GoPro videos in Mission Beach.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of A-listers can't do stuff like that without getting hounded. And that's just not my, that's not my bag, man.
When you mentioned the NASA thing, I wanted to bring up one trivia thing that I found about you, that there are many, many people who have heard your voice and didn't know it was you, which is at the Holocaust Museum.
Yes. Yeah, how cool is that, man?
When they have, I guess, the listening tour, you're you're one of the characters.
That's me. At the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., I am the voice of Daniel, and I take you through the tour of the exhibit called Remember the Children. Okay. It's very sad. I remember booking this early on in my career. I didn't know if I wanted just to act, if I wanted to do voiceovers, if I wanted to go back into music. So I was doing everything, spreading myself too thin. Yeah. But the agent I was working with, she said, listen, there's a voiceover for a character at the new, before it was open, Holocaust Museum.
Exactly.
And Smithsonian. And they're having a national audition. And she's like, you kind of have like this quality about your voice that I, you know, I think that you might have be a good candidate for it. So I was like, eh, all right. So I went to National Geographic, and I didn't know what I was doing. And they were like, just read. I was like, just read? Yeah, just read. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I read it. And they didn't say anything. And I'm like, oh, God, I bombed. And they're like, wait here. So they pulled in a couple more people, and I'm like, oh, this might be good. Can you do that again? Sure. So they gave me a little more direction, and like I said, let go of what you think is right, and just take direction from whatever they said.
Sure.
And they said, can you give me different inflection? And I don't want you just to pretend like you're there, because we can't really pretend that we're there. I want to hear a little more friendly tone from you, because it's such a drab story. Mm-hmm. You know, like when you remember your sister, and when you remember, you know, the ball that you had, and the train with the family, because I still remember some of the stuff I said. So I did it my way, and I booked it. And I think they said out of almost 3,000, 4,000 submissions, I got the job.
You got it.
Yeah, man.
Way to go.
Yeah, so if you ever go to the Smithsonian Holocaust in Washington, D.C., I'm the voice of Daniel, and my voice will be in the archives for life.
There you go. You're already immortal.
Banging. I am a 300-year-old man.
There you go.
So, yeah, man, that was a fun gig.
So what we want you to do, we don't really don't want to stop because we're having so much fun here. But if you could look into your camera there, which you're pro, you know, anyway, and tell people your contact information, how they can keep up with your such a busy schedule.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. Let me see. First one would be, you can check me out on Instagram, and that's just johnny.alonzo on Instagram. My website, johnnyalonzo.com. Twitter, Johnny Alonzo. And of course, Facebook, Johnny Alonzo. If you go to YouTube, I do have a YouTube page, and that's Johnny Alonzo 1. So that should cover it. And,
All right.
Yeah, hit me up with email. I'll respond. I still have time.
Okay. Well, thank you for stopping by, Johnny, to our humble little studio here in Lansdowne.
It's a great place. I mean, I took the elevator all the way up to the 13th floor. This place is beautiful.
All right. So once again, thanks for stopping by, Johnny.
My pleasure.
And don't be a stranger.
No, I won't.
Well, either when you come in town, we'll have you. If Marty can have you, I can have you.
Absolutely.
And also, you know, hey, you know, when you're doing Riddle House, we might do that Skype thing. I'd like to do that Skype thing.
That's a guarantee.
All right.
We'll do it from Hollywood.
That'll be terrific.
Thanks.
Live from Hollywood.
Yeah, man.
It's Johnny Alonzo. All right. Well, then I've got to stop. And so, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. We had another fun interview here at TV Free Baltimore's Movie Reviews with Johnny Alonzo. And so until next time, this is Paul Stefan. And like they used to say, I'll see you at the movies.
We hope you're enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
You're watching The Paul Stefan Show on TV Free Baltimore.
Hello, it's Paul Stefan. And we're here tonight breaking new ground. It's the first time we've had a musician on our show, and we hope to soon have a musical show where we go out to gigs and introduce the world to some bands that not enough people know, but they should. And one of those is our guest tonight. She is a musician of both keyboards and guitar, and also composes songs, and is a businesswoman. And that is Athena Hiotis. Welcome, Athena.
Thank you so much for having me.
Well, it's great to have you here. Now, you just did have a gig Saturday night.
I did, yes, at the Metro Gallery.
Okay, great. And this was with the group Rev.
Yes.
And you've been involved, or we have here, I thought there were currently four groups, you know, which is the Queens of Noise, Rev, Steep Steps, and the Circuit Villains.
Circuit Villains, yeah. I'm involved in many projects, but really only two of them are active bands. Mm-hmm. That's Rev and Circuit Villains. Mm-hmm. Steep Steps is a production duo between myself and Tony Corelli, who is a local mm-hmm. engineer. We specifically work with darker, trippier electronic music.
Right.
And then the Queens of Noise is it's a Runaways tribute band, and just a bunch of friends of mine and I mm-hmm. got together and maybe once or twice a year just paid tribute to one of the best all-girl rock bands of the 70s and just party.
Well, that's terrific. So people should mostly, when they look for you, look for Rev.
Yep.
And the Circuit Villains.
Yeah, Circuit Villains, yeah.
Have they had gigs yet, the Circuit Villains?
Circuit Villains, we are less than a week new. So
okay, no gigs yet.
Newly borns. currently writing and planning our attack. Probably in the fall. We'll make some decisions about shows, but that's a fun one. It's a fun little project.
To help people understand then these two main projects of yours,
sure.
Say what genre the music is of Rev and what will be the genre of the Circuit Villains.
So Circuit Villains is, we like to refer to it as unapologetically groovy. Like there's a groove rock to it. You know, it gets your hips moving. Mm-hmm. For fans of Royal Blood, Muse, Queens of the Stone Age, St. Vincent. Rev is cinematic indie art rock. So for fans of Radiohead, Muse, genres like that. I mean, with Rev, it's a little bit more dipping into the composition realm because there are classical elements. If we drew a Venn diagram of the two bands, they would meet. There would be just a little sliver in the middle. But for me, they're like a Jekyll and Hyde.
Okay.
Very, very interesting, complementary projects that have now made me feel more balanced of a writer, as far as you know, rock is concerned. So, yeah.
Well, that's great. And are they different? Totally different personnel besides you? You're the one common factor? Or?
I am the one common denominator, yes. But yeah. With Rev, it's myself, Nicholas Cosmas, who's a multi-instrumentalist, plays bass in the band. Sharif Taher is a jazz drummer. And then we have Scott Griffith come in on guitar. And then, of course, we pull in different instruments. If we need a violinist or a cellist, we know a lot of people that do that. With Circuit Villains, it's Sam Brewer on drums and Stephen Thomas on guitar. And then, one very special, awesome someone will be dropping in on bass. We have to figure that out.
Oh, okay. But I did see, I saw a Rev video mm-hmm. where you were like co-singing with a woman who was out front too. And she was, I think, playing guitar and she had blue hair or something. And it was like a...
A video.
I think it was. It was supposed to be in the living room or something.
Yes.
The video was in the living room.
Yes. The last year is a band from Baltimore. They're excellent. Check them out. Mm-hmm. They, for a while, did a series, I believe for about a year or so, where they brought in different musicians and they covered a song.
Oh.
And so Nikki had us in... to do a Fiona Apple song, so that was a lot of fun.
That was what it was.
Yes.
Now, see, I jugged your memory on that one. Now, here's a thing for you. I know I saw something that said you sat down at a piano at 11 months old.
Yeah.
But
where did your love of music come from?
I don't mean to cheat the answer, but I don't remember a time where I discovered my love of music. I feel like it's kind of like my arm. I was always born with it. Mm-hmm. So I don't really know life without it. I can pinpoint parts of my early childhood where, you know, at 11 months, my parents have videos of me playing piano. Right. And at a very early age, I was playing along with songs. And I've always loved music.
And you were influenced, weren't you, at home? I understand you said something about Dad was a rocker?
Dad was a rocker. Dad is also a multi-instrumentalist. He's the reason I picked up a guitar. Okay. There's actually a picture of me as a baby strumming on the guitar, and he was like teaching me the chords.
Wow.
But my parents were very supportive. I'm very fortunate to have that. You know, they bought me a small play school keyboard super young and have always had it in my life.
But you weren't one of those, what was it, Suzuki Method type musicians? Or
I learned both by ear and by going to school for it. So right. I advocate both very equally. I was very fortunate to be able to go to school for music. And so I feel like there's an importance to education and exercising one's ability to listen.
So you're not somebody who says, hey, you know, I just play by ear, or I picked it up, or, you know,
no,
you were trained.
No. I mean, I picked it up, but it was nurtured. I was lucky to go to school for it. My high school was an art school, and I went to University of Maryland College Park for music.
Right. And part of that, I understand, was voice that you had
yes.
at the University of Maryland.
Yes.
So that's, again, just your singing is not just your gift. It got cultivated somewhat.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Mm. Now, for you then, you know, growing up, you're exposed maybe to different kinds of music. You know, are there certain genres that you really like, or, you know, are things like, you know, that type of music?
Sure.
What kind of genres are you interested in or have been interested in?
Well, I've always loved pop music.
Okay.
That's sort of the unpopular answer. I feel like I'm shunned as a rocker. I love pop music. It's taught me to write a good melody. Mm-hmm. It's taught me about simplicity in the parts that mm-hmm. it's actually very much like arranging an orchestration. You don't just have one block of sounds, mm-hmm. one block of sounds that just create this wall of sound. You have different melodies and counterpoints and
Keep going?
All right, cool. Pop music has taught me a lot about being able to take the little pieces of the puzzle and to create a wall of sound from that, which, again, also is very much like orchestration and mm-hmm. Working in a classical setting. I grew up listening to classical music, so I feel like those two went hand in hand. Mm-hmm. But my dad, he used to play The Police for me all the time.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, The Police, Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely a rock influence there. As far as non-mainstream influences, I love Middle Eastern and Mediterranean music.
Oh, there you go.
I mean, they really do tap into different modes and scales, but the unconventional usage of, well, the usage of unconventional instruments and the unconventional usage of conventional instruments,
uh-huh.
either because there's a lack of excess or access in those mm-hmm. particular countries, or obviously because they have a whole different cultural makeup is really interesting to me. To be able to question, okay, so I pluck the guitar this way, but you know, when you play the oud, you know, maybe you pluck it a different way. Maybe you're not using your wrist in a certain way. I feel like it just allows you to expand your palate. And the reason why I'm such an advocate about education, whether formal or just listening to another country's music, is mm-hmm. you really do expand your arsenal. Mm-hmm. Your armory just becomes more and more filled with different things. And you start implementing that, and rock isn't just rock. Rock is now something else, something that's harder to explain, but mm-hmm. it stands out. So well, there's your long answer.
Well, it's okay. I like the long answers. That, to me, then, rock has evolved in the
I think from what you're telling me, sort of the way I also see jazz. You can say jazz, but jazz means a million different things.
Of course. And, oh, yeah.
And so does rock. You can say, oh, is it acid rock? Is it alt rock? Mm-hmm. You know, is it art rock?
Oh, yeah. And what is art rock?
You know, all of that. So that, you know, and I'll let you like to be, have you experimented then with these different stringed instruments you're talking about from other countries, like the oud or the bouzouki or, you know, the balalaika? Or, you know.
We actually did use the bouzouki in our song Orpheus.
Oh, you did?
Rev's song Orpheus, which is in on La Marionette.
Right.
And that was awesome. I hope to do more of that. We've been talking about challenging ourselves at some point and the ideal situation would be to go to these countries, but to be able to open ourselves up to musical aspects of countries that we don't really interact with on the day-to-day, and then see what we can learn and borrow and implement into a song. And that's our song to them.
Interesting.
It's a great, it's a challenge, but I think it would be extremely rewarding.
Yeah, so, yeah. I mean, the fusion, in a sense, of different cultures and expressing it in rock, I guess, is the way to put it. Because I noticed, you were talking about hearkening back, what comes to me is the Beatles would do that. I mean, remember the thing they did? They had the sitar. And they'd have the symphony stuff in Norwegian wood and all that kind of stuff. So they used a lot of other different instruments, not necessarily ethnic all the time.
Absolutely, sure.
But, you know, say that, but in fact, if you want to, I think it'd be a little harder to compose because of, you know, the different, you know, they use different time signatures and everything else.
Absolutely. I mean, time signatures and then also different aspects and approaches to pitch. I mean, you know, you look at a piano, you have, you know, 12 notes in a scale to choose. You know, you have C and C sharp, but yet you take a stringed instrument and then you don't just have C and C sharp. You have all those little scents in between because you're dealing with a fretless board. But then you have instruments like the oud, where there are pitches within the pitches that we would recognize as Western listeners.
Okay.
So that would be really interesting.
A challenge, maybe?
A challenge for sure, especially when you're dealing with, you know, the piano.
Mm-hmm.
And
also, I mean, influence because of your heritage, I guess some Greek music would
absolutely.
Be.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, yeah. My bassist and I are Nick and I are Greek, so we.
Okay.
Yeah, it's been a wild ride to be able to borrow things.
Well, I bet it has. Now I'm trying to think where I want to go with it. Now, as far as when did you decide that you wanted to be a musician your whole life again?
I was in 10th grade when I realized that music was something that I wanted to do more than writing in my room, which is where at the very core of it, I love writing. And if that's all I had, then that would be fine. But going to the art school that I went to exposed me to performance and collaboration, and I just fell in love with it. It was an addiction. So I would say around college when I started playing out, you know, first bands and everything like that, and just kind of seeing how people were reacting to it, that was like, this is something.
Now, one of the things Till wanted to bring up, it seems like, you know, bring up pop rock.
Pop Riot.
Pop Riot, I mean. That your company, in a sense, you talk about the music business and the business of music. And you even, you know, gave a talk at the Carroll County Community College about that. Now, why don't you expand or tell us a little bit about your sense of, because I would say, let me just set it up, is to say that most musicians, at least in the old days, when they signed contracts, you know, and they would get nothing, you know, and the label would get everything. And unless, of course, you know, you were the songwriter.
Yes.
And, but a lot of time the acts didn't. I mean, even Elvis was stole from, you know, so, so I'm just saying that, you know, tell us a little bit about your company and what you have to say about the business of music and helping musicians understand that it's not a them-us kind of thing?
I could go on forever talking about...
Well, take your time.
People tend to idolize the decades of the 70s, 80s, 90s, even the early 2000s. And there were probably no... those were probably some of the most detrimental decades to musicians because you had such a limited number of opportunities and roads. You know, you had a very finite number of labels that owned pretty much everything. I mean, again, this is before the internet, before any access was brought to us. So you pretty much had to sign this contract, which at that time, yeah, they would take away your songwriting credits, which they knew songwriting is the most important thing. We live in a time today where you are able to do anything you want if you plan accordingly and you invest accordingly. Somewhere along the way, musicians learned, were taught, evolved, I'm not sure, to think that the business aspect is not rock and roll or too much to understand or not meant for them. And so me going out and teaching them about the industry, about the fundamentals, is really to give them an understanding that they can make anything happen. Mm-hmm. That if you walk into a situation where you have signed over credits that you shouldn't have, in today's day and age, it's your fault. The label is not out to get you. There are sharks out there like there would be in any field. But again, we live in a time where you can take your time, do your research. Attorneys aren't that expensive that you can't have them review a contract. And so my goal is to give musicians a fighting chance, starting with education. Mm-hmm. You know, even if your goal is to get signed or to find, you know, an agent, which is something that everyone should do, you have to know what you're looking for and you have to know how it works before you start interviewing people for the position. Pop Riot for me is an expression of that. It's my label. It's a label that we started to provide an outlet that's affordable, not just financially, but also having to do with knowledge, having to do with education. So these series that these lecture series that I give are just that. I mean, I believe we always do them free of charge. However, there have been instances where we worked with art centers where the money will go to the art center.
Right.
But I just want bands to be smarter, to not accept the status quo that I've been looked at many times with that glossy-eyed look of, you want to be a musician? Ugh. And it's just like, I don't accept that. I don't accept that response, and neither should anyone else. But with that, I believe that we need to start with the fundamentals. And when we say things like, I want to sign to a label, what does that mean? You know, and I do one-on-one consultations with bands all the time, and the first thing I'll ask them is, what is your goal? And they can't even articulate it for a multitude of reasons. You know, they're afraid of the word fame, which, you know, you shouldn't be, because fame is only the fact that a lot of people know who you are. That's it. That's all that fame is. It's not a bad word. Don't let anyone tell you that it's a bad word. To not managing financials, there are ways that bands could prepare. Like I said, I can go on forever, but I'm very passionate about giving musicians the tools to pretty much say, this is what I want. This is how we're going to get it. Do you want to help us? And to be able to know how to ask for that.
Well, I know part of it, I mean, with the music scene has changed, especially since the internet, to say that, you know, a lot of people do self-produce their own music. I mean, they do it in their home studio, throw it up on the internet, that kind of thing. And sometimes they get thousands, you know, of hits.
Oh, yeah.
But then you have to be able to get whatever, you know, your percentages, if it's Spotify or wherever, you know, get your money. But, you know, it's different if you sign. And because that's what I was going to ask about you, I go along with that, how it seems like you consult with people, say, individuals or groups that want to, you know, become musicians or be a band, and how they get themselves out there, because there's a lot to it. You talk about signing, but there are things like publicity.
Oh, yeah.
Landing gigs. Yeah. You know, how do you get known? You know, do I have an agent? Do I not have an agent?
Yeah.
Do I do a video and, you know, farm it all around, or, you know, that kind of thing?
Yeah, there is so much out there, and there are so many ways to do anything that it gets a bit overwhelming. And what I tell people is, you must identify your goals and you must identify your parameters. If if you wanted to come over to my house, you would need an address, or else you'd be driving senselessly and burning up resources. Right. So if a band can't even say, I want to be able to sell out venues that have a 2,000 capacity limit, I want to be able to do a world tour, I want to sign to this, you know, booking agent so that I can open up for them. I mean, we're talking specific goals, and it's very difficult for people. I mean, it was difficult for me to be able to say, I want to do X, Y, and Z. But also, when you identify your goals, what are you willing and not willing to do in order to get there? Mm-hmm. You know, no one in Rev is highly social media. We don't like it. It needs to be calculated. And you know, there you go. That's our parameter. We are not the people that post something every day. So what does that mean? Okay, cool. So if you don't want to post something every day, well, then you need to make sure that you plan out your posts and that you boost them a little bit so that you are gaining that visibility and that reach another way. Mm-hmm. There's an answer and a way for everything, but there must be the willingness to accept the fact that if you have a goal and you have these parameters set, then you might need to drive a little bit longer. If you want to come over to my place, but you don't want to go over the bridge, there's right. a way. It might add on about 30 minutes.
Right.
And I just want bands to know it's not that hard. It's tough, but it's not hard.
Now, speaking of that, and bring it home to you, what are your goals musically?
I am a big fan of St. Vincent.
Okay.
Right now, she has been touring for about a year and a half on her album, Mass Seduction, and she is touring the world. Mm-hmm. I would love to reach that level, that ability to put out an album and to be able to play the anthem or the queen in Delaware and to be able to go to Europe and to have dedicated fans that come out. Mm-hmm. Would everyone know who I am? No, and that's okay. We don't need everyone knowing who I am. But you know, my goal is, as far as a performing aspect, for Rev and Circuit Villains to get that level of notoriety and access. Mm-hmm. I want to continue writing and composing for film, mm-hmm. and to continue helping bands, and hopefully at a much larger level.
Well, that's great. And part of what I want to bring up to is another aspect is the writing that you have done for short films and feature films. And to say, how do you find, as far as composing, how is it different? Let's say you're writing for the band as opposed to you're writing for a movie.
Absolutely.
Explain the differences there.
Well, when you're writing for the band, the song is the center point mm-hmm. of the entire delivery of the package. You're creating something and you're giving it to the audience, and if they like it, great. If they don't, well, you know, oh well. When you're writing for film or you're writing to a motion picture, that's the centerpiece. Mm-hmm. And you can't take away from that. And there are certain aspects and certain writing styles that in and of themselves are very cinematic and powerful, but when they accompany motion picture, they're not as powerful because you have two headstrong components. So the first thing you do is, the first thing I do is I watch the clip and I write down what I feel. And of course, if the director has given any cues during the spotting session, that's important as well. But then I sit down and I come up with a melody. I always try to start with a melody and then build from there. And then play it together, watch it a few zillion times, and then I go off of emotion more than anything else. And then as far as orchestration, you know, I scale it back to be a little bit more technical. So.
Now, in the work that you've done, have you done primarily like theme songs, or have you done a whole score for a movie?
I have done both. I've done scoring once, and it was kind of an unfortunate situation because for some reason, the movie never got released, which was very upsetting.
Yeah, I imagine.
Yeah, but the experience was incredible, and I learned a lot. Mostly I've done theme songs or songs to be used individually in a specific scene.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, I think I prefer the latter. I mean, the composition and the you know, the scoring the entire film is amazing. But you know, I think I always favor the more thematic segments than
anything else. Yeah, so either it's a song at the beginning of the movie, the end of the movie, or scene in the middle.
Oh, they're powerful. They're just that's powerful.
Well, that's where that's smart, because you know that's where usually they grab for singles.
So many times I've watched, you know, I've gone to see a movie and I'm like, Shazam, what is this? What is this?
Who did that one, right? Is this? Now, with writing, for example, where do you get your ideas for songs?
I always like to hear drums first. I mean, are you talking lyrically or musically?
I'm asking you just to say, okay, where does the I'm just going to leave it like that. The idea for a song, you know, start there. And then I'll go to the next part, which maybe I'll give it to you now to help you.
Sure.
Part B would be, for you, what comes first,
music
or lyrics?
Okay, so the idea of a song for me is heavily influenced by any story that I want to tell, usually always reflecting some part of me. I base it off of mythology, whether classical mythology, or I will use components of Joseph Campbell's writings or Alan Watts as sort of a translation, you know, thought to paper. But for me, it's really emotional. If I'm writing songs that are dealing with a journey, it's probably mixed with a lot of anxiety or fear or restlessness or knowing that there's something more out there, which I'm sure everyone goes through and has gone through in their lives. I sort of am a slave to whatever comes out. You know, I have a book that I carry. I'm kind of neurotic with books. I have a book for every project, but I have one book that I always carry around that's my stream of consciousness.
Oh, okay.
Pen to paper. Sometimes it's impossible to decipher what I've written, but whatever I feel is getting written down. So part A would be, as far as ideas, whatever comes out, okay. Whatever needs to come out will come out.
And it'll be mostly an emotion or a gut feeling.
Yes, absolutely. Gut feeling. And how it's represented, that's the fun part, you know,
Okay. Drawing
the pictures after you've laid the dots out.
Okay.
As far as musically, lyrics will always be sort of written by themselves, but I solidify the lyrics after the music's done.
So the music really starts for you.
That's just, you want to get the waterfall just completely rushing, just the music first. Because you take a chord, you can play like C, G, and you can go anywhere with that. Well, you start adding drums and you start adding a bass line. I mean, there are so many times in these projects where we're together and an idea comes to the table in one way. Drummer starts changing some stuff. Any idea that I may have had before is gone now. Because it's like, now you've got a different groove.
Okay.
And now the bassist is playing something maybe a little bit, it's got a little bit of a kick in the backbeat instead of being so heavy in the forefront. So yeah, I would say music first.
But it sounds like you're even composing with the band, sort of.
Yeah,
you kind of give them some chords or give them an idea, you know, maybe a few lines of music, and then it starts going off, and they kind of contribute. Oh, now let me write that down. Let me get that in there.
Oh, it's the best.
It's collaborative.
It is collaborative. I used to be the complete opposite with music. I wanted to write everything, and I was such a control freak. But then you just feel the energy, and you just feel how these songs have been taken to another level, to another realm. And that only happens when you collaborate. I mean, the best songwriters, the best composers in the world, there will eventually be a redundancy in the theme. I mean, Hans Zimmer is one of my favorite composers, modern day composers. Even his themes tend to, you know, you can kind of listen to it and go, oh yeah, that's Hans Zimmer. So in my opinion, anytime you take an idea and you bring someone else, you're getting every little idiosyncrasy, any tendency that they have, you're making a baby. You're making something very unique and special. So now I'm kind of addicted to it.
So as it is, it's like you do write the lyrics and the music yourself. You don't say there's circumstances where you just wrote the music and somebody else wrote the lyrics, or you don't do those kind of songwriting collaborations, do you?
I have, but they're probably... No, they're not for like my main projects. I've done that for other artists, but no, for main projects, you know, if there's an idea, bring it to the table, and then, you know, oh hey, what do you guys think about this? What do you guys? I mean, even if I've written most of the lyrics, I'll always kick it to everyone and go, hey, what do you think? And we have a song on La Marionette called Inheritance, and I brought in the second verse to Nick, our bassist, and he literally just flipped two words.
Oh, okay.
And it changed the entire song, and it just made it. I mean, he wrote more than those two words, but just what he saw in what I brought and what he was able to do with it, I mean, that's the lines make the song.
Well, that's great. Yeah. I thought maybe part of the reasons why you have Pop Riot is that it allows you to keep control of your own music.
That is a reason, yeah. Pop Riot is my label. It protects the members in the bands. It protects the music. I mean, of course, if there's an opportunity that comes along in the future, we'll obviously consider it as objectively as we can. But right now, we have an opportunity to be able to work professionally and efficiently and not worry about the intentions of those that are helping us. So,
I mean, are you also... had any thoughts or had projects where you were the songwriter for hire? I mean, say, well, we need a song, so would Athena, would you write it for us? You
know, I have done that. Okay. I worked with pop artist Erica Ashley a few years ago, and I worked with pop country artist Emily Kern before she went off to college. So that was a very, you know, here's what I'm thinking, here's what I'm feeling, wrote the songs, and then
terrific.
It was cool. It was very cool. I love that.
Okay, and now if you could tell us and tell our audience what's maybe coming down the line here this summer, you know, where people might be able to see you or see your group.
Sure.
Let us know.
Absolutely. So if you are interested in keeping up with me and the bands that I'm in, you can check out officialrev.com. It's official, R-E-V-E.com. We will list all of our show dates there. CircuitVillains.com. That will be that's a brand new project. Very excited about that. You'll be seeing new information there in the next coming, I would say, weeks or so. Steep Steps, always doing a lot of songwriting and production there. If you're into dark, electronic, glitchy music, that would be steepsteps.net. And AthenaHiotis.com. You can always check it out. And drop me a line if you'd like.
That's terrific. And also, I want to wish you an early happy birthday.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's the 19th.
The 19th. Yes.
It's coming up. And I don't know if you're having a blast for it or not.
Oh, I love getting older.
You do?
I do, yeah. I love it.
Because some people don't.
No. Every crow's feet that pops up, I get happier.
Oh, well, hey, you're comfortable with it. There you go. That's good. Yeah. And, of course, we can't do it right now, but when we do come back, we're going to have you play something for us and
absolutely
give our audience a treat. So we'll be right back with that in a minute. We're not ready to say goodbye to Athena just yet.
Cool.
And that's so much more.
You're watching The Paul Stefan Show on TV Free Baltimore.
Hello, I'm Steve Darnall, the publisher of Nostalgia Digest, and you're watching TV Free Baltimore. Well done.
The Despacito is on my shore, Maryland, my Maryland. His torch is at thy temple door, Maryland, my Maryland. Avenge the patriotic roar of Baltimore, and be the battle queen of yore, Maryland, my Maryland. Thou wilt but cower in the dust, Maryland, my Maryland. Remember carols, sacred trust.
This concludes another day of live stream broadcasting from TV Free Baltimore.